Silverware. It's what every footballer plays for. And it's notoriously hard to come by. Most play their entire career without getting their hands on the prize. This afternoon, 23 VFL players will realise their dream of climbing that podium and hoisting that cup. Will it be the season pace setters, Casey, finally winning their first of the century? Or will it be the newcomers from the north, Southport, winning their first? 4 quarters of football to decide who gets to fulfil their premiership dream. It's the 2022 VFL Grand Final. Casey and Southport on 7 VFL Finals Footy. 21 teams have been whittled down to two in the race for the 2022 VFL Premiership, and it's the two teams who led the competition for much of the season. They're head-to-head for the title in what will be a history-making afternoon. As we welcome you to Princes Park, these days known as Icon Park in Carlton, Jason Bennett alongside Campbell Brown and Michael Barlow for the 2022 VFL Grand Final, Casey and Southport. And Brownie, the pressure of expectation, I guess, on the Ds. They've gone 19-1, had a phenomenal season, now they need to convert.
Yeah, they certainly do. They've been the benchmark for the whole season, only dropping one game. And as a player, you really feel that expectation. Quite envious every other player in the competition that you're playing today, so it's a real privilege.
Mickey, the Southport Sharks have been outstanding since they joined the VFL last season. They went 9-1 in 2021 to shape as a premiership contender before the season was abandoned, and they ended 2022 determined to do it again, and they have.
Yeah, they're a great story, aren't they? Last year they were up and about, and they've transitioned that form straight into this year. The only standalone club to make the finals, so 7 aligned clubs in the Southport Sharks, and here they are on the last day.
So let's break this game down by zone. We're going to begin our analysis at Southport's end of the ground. We're going to look at Southport's attack versus Casey's defence. And Brownie, what a matchup this should be. Casey number one in defence, Southport number one in attack.
Yeah, they're a really miserly defence. Hard team to score against Casey. They really buy into full ground defence. Their back six is superb one-on-one, and it's all based around winning one-on-ones. The intercept mark game. Tomlinson, Buntine, Allison back there. They really do defend dangerous space, take the intercept marks, and that starts a lot of the Casey drive offensively.
So from a Southport perspective, they don't have those big key forwards. What are they going to do?
No, they don't. They're pretty mobile. Their forwards are dangerous. Townsend, very mature player in the front half. Billy Gow is off an AFL list and a really mature state league player. But they've also got speed. They've got Zach Foote. They've got Peskett. And they've got goal-kicking accuracy in front of goal when they get the opportunities. Have a look at those goal kickers. They spread the load and they get the ball inside forward 50 enough to give these guys opportunity.
Let's look at the Casey end of the ground now. We'll look at Casey's attack versus Southport's defence. The Ds, number two in attack. The Sharks, number five in defence. Brownie, Casey's got the most cohesive midfield forward unit. When they get it inside 50, they're the best in the comp at converting it into goals.
Yeah, their efficiency has been absolutely superb. And the balance right between their talls and their smalls. Obviously, you've got Brown up there and Van Ruin, who's had a terrific year. Tom McDonald's not going to be present today. He's out injured. But they get Melksham back in there. And Sam Wiedemann, the last few weeks, has been playing ruck. But he drifts forward as well. They're tools, they take marks, and if they don't, they bring it to ground for Chandler, Laurie, White, Bedford and Gray, and they hit the scoreboard as well.
From a Southport perspective, Mickey, they don't have a tall defence.
They don't at all, so they rely on pressure through the midfield to make sure that ball movement of Casey today it will be nullified and bring that dirty ball in. So the undersized guys, they've got Spencer, they've got Clark, they've got Tate. Hopefully they can win or halve as many contests as possible in that defensive 50.
Gold Coast exposed them last week with really quick ball movement as well, and they found out the Southport defence.
Which leads us into the midfield battle. Brownie, as Mick mentioned, Casey's so efficient with the ball.
Yeah, they are. They bring manic tackle pressure and they win the ball back. Bold ball movement that they bring through the corridor as well, and they set up so well defensively. They've got a lot of class players that use the ball and make the right decisions with ball in hand coming through the corridor.
Mickey, you look at those numbers, you'd expect Southport to win the inside battle. That happened last time. They were plus 19 for clearances, but Casey just set up so well behind it.
At Casey Fields as well that game, so they play that ground really well. Different environment today, but the Southport middle will be so reliant on Braden Crossley to get to work, get first use to his midfielders, and then they've just got to be a bit cleaner with their ball use when they do get first possession, unlike that time they last met.
Crosley should try and monster Wiedemann in the ruck, and Wiedemann's advantage will be around the ground. He's got to run him into submission.
Dawson, Woodcock, Joyce and Foote last week, 38 clearances between them in the prelim final. That might be the key to the game. Here's the Demons. They'll be led out by skipper Mitch White. He and Jimmy Munro, their spiritual leader, both playing their third VFL grand final. After being part of the 2016 and 2018 teams, which fell short,
Luke Dunstan in that midfield. Chandler's had a good year as well. They've got so much talent. This is the most dominant team that White and Munro have been a part of. 19-1, great blend of youth and experience, 15 AFL-listed players. They've got all the pieces.
Yeah, they do. And Jimmy Munro last week, 27 touches, 8 clearances. He was superb. Mitch White played a different role. He went to Reece Matheson last week after quarter time and really did a lockdown run with role. Great leadership, great role for his club.
Well, the D's are ready to come out. Let's bring them out onto Icon Park now. The Casey Demons, the minor premiers, 19-1 in 2022. But they've been minor premiers on three occasions previously and haven't been able to get the job done this century. It's been a bit of a story of missed opportunities. They've won 17 of 23 finals this century, Mickey.
Yeah, and today's a really good opportunity for the Casey Football Club, but also Melbourne. Melbourne going out in straight. A lot of these guys, 15 AFL listed, as we mentioned, will be looking to put a little cherry on top of their season, which has been a great season as a club. AFL's faltered, but the VFL can go all the way.
Let's take a look at their lineup. As you mentioned, 15 AFL-listed players.
It's a really strong side, isn't it? You've got a feel for Fraser Rossman that got the concussion last week. Jake Bowie wasn't eligible to play today. Tommy McDonald didn't come up and Rowan Steele are out. But in come Laurie Wiedemann, Quigley and Jake Melchum, which adds a tremendous amount of drive and experience.
They've got so much talent at all ends of the ground. They have been the competition benchmark. Now it comes down to whether they can convert on grand final day.
And there's a pressure to being the overwhelming favourites. You know, that's something that everyone coming here today or watching is expecting them to win.
And they've been really dominant in both of their finals, haven't they? So they've owned both games, and today will be a watch.
Well, Casey coach Mark Corrigan played in two VFL grand finals for Geelong. He won one and lost one. Now he coaches his first in his second year in charge at the D's. Here he is with Nigel Carmody.
Mark, congratulations on making it to the decider. This time 2 years ago, you're working as a landscaper after getting stood down during the COVID shutdown in a year where you were going to coach Essendon's VFL team. Have you had a chance this week to reflect on what's been a pretty tumultuous couple of years?
Yeah, absolutely, Nigel. And I think that period just gives you a greater appreciation for where we are today and for how much I love the coaching element and the role that I've got. So incredibly fortunate, although it's probably similar weather to when I was digging holes and planting trees, mate.
Grand final weeks have always got a little bit of selection drama around them. You've had a couple of unlucky players go out of your team with injury, particularly Fraser Rossman with the concussion. But experience and youth comes in. Great opportunities for Jake Melksham and Aiden Quigley.
Absolutely. You nailed it. Steele really unfortunately misses out, and that's disappointing. We'd love to get him in, but unfortunately we can't. But Quigs, we know what he played the final against Sydney, and Melky's been in great form at AFL level, mate. So we feel like we're really balanced and we've got a good blend of youth and experience.
Mark, all the best.
Thank you, Nice.
Well, the Southport Sharks might be a standalone club, Mickey, but they're stacked with former AFL listed talent as well, including the men who finished second and third in the Liston Trophy this year, Jacob Dawson and Boyd Woodcock. Relatively mature, 21 of their 23 players aged 21 or older.
Yeah, really important in the modern landscape of the VFL competition. You have to play six players under the age of 20, under the age of 22. So to get their players closer to that age level of 22, really important. And a lot of these guys have fallen off AFL lists. A lot of Gold Coast locals that have stayed at home and trying to build something really, really special at the Southport Sharks. So have a look at them coming out. They're a really connected group and a really mature group, and that'll stand up on grand final day.
Why they've got the Collingwood theme song. They were originally the Southport Magpies. They moved to another competition where there were two Magpies. They tossed a coin. They became the Sharks.
Well, there you go. And they've got the black and white. They've held on to it. But the Sharks, they have an aquarium at their home ground. So Adds to the amazing
facilities.
They've got everything at their home ground. Southport coach Steve Daniel, he's been a winner everywhere he's been, and he's been just about everywhere. Here he is with Nudge.
Steve, congrats to you and the Sharks on making the grand final and another grand final in your incredible journey in the game as a coach. Tell us, what's got to change from round seven, apart from 6-2 to nothing at quarter time, to get Casey's number today?
Look, they're just got to stay in the game early. That's what it's all about. Try and put the pressure back on them a little bit and just hang in as long as we can.
You've got a really connected group. How much are the references from winning a NEAFL title in 18 going to count today?
Look, I'm going to hope they put us in some pretty good stead. So the boys are up for it. It's exciting. They're pretty pumped. So let's just hope we have a really good game.
Steve, all the best.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
15 grand finals for 10 flags. Steve Daniels, an amazing record. Two teams on the verge of realising their premiership dream. It's the 2022 VFL Grand Final. It's Casey at Southport, and it's next. The 2022 VFL Grand Final, that's what it's all about. Getting your hands on the silverware. And as we mentioned at the start of the show, so many players, Brownie, go their whole careers and never get the chance.
They certainly do. It's an absolute privilege to be out there playing today. And you might only get one opportunity in your life to win a premiership. Today could be that day for these players.
Well, all is in readiness for the 2022 VFL Grand Final. It's time for our pre-game formalities. Here's our master of ceremonies, Pete Blazer.
Good afternoon and welcome to Icon Park for the 2022 Smithies VFL Grand Final to be played between the Casey Demons and Southport Sharks. For our welcome to country, it's my pleasure to introduce Wurundjeri Elder, Uncle Colin Hunter.
I'd like to start off by acknowledging that this afternoon we are meeting on the lands of my ancestors, the Wurundjeri people, and I'd like to take this opportunity to pay my respects to my elders, both past, present and emerging, elders from all nations, but I particularly want to pay my respects to everyone gathered here today. Wurundjeri, welcome. Wurundjeri Balik, Yiman Kondi Bik. The Wurundjeri people welcome everyone to land today. Wurundjeri, no, Budambor War, Kondi Nengnak, Dubinan Bik, Bullock Bor, Tillikan. The Wurundjeri people want to look after and protect the land as they did long before. Wurundjeri country extends from the inner city of Melbourne. It goes across the mountains of the Great Dividing Range, west to the Werribee River, south to the Mordialloc Creek and east to Mount Baw-Baw. And the Wurundjeri people are part of the Kulin Nation and of the Wawong language group. And while you're on Wurundjeri country, you're most welcome to the traditional lands and the waterways of the Wurundjeri people. So, Wurundjeri, welcome. Enjoy the game.
Thank you, Uncle Colin Hunter. Ladies and gentlemen, if you are able to do so, would you now please be upstanding and join with the players, coaches and umpires as we welcome Nina Ferrer to perform the National Anthem of Australia.
Australians, all let us rejoice, for we are one and free. We've golden soil and wealth for toil. Our home is girt by sea. Our land abounds in nature's gifts of beauty rich and rare. In history's page, let every stage advance Australia fair. In joyful strains, then let us sing.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Enjoy the Smithies VFL Grand Final.
So Nigel Carmody, Casey have won three minor premierships in the last decade for grand final appearances of 2016 and 18, but haven't been able to convert those into a flag. They led at halftime in 2016, at three-quarter time in 2018. Mitch White, Jimmy Munro, both featuring in those two grand finals.
Fresh blood in the team, and state league football competitions have the most list turnover of any level of the game, and there's not a great reference point from those 16 and 18 teams in terms of personnel. Sam Wiedemann, Joel Smith, Munro and White, as you mentioned as well, and a similar story with Southport, just five, six players coming out of that NEAFL premiership some 4 years ago.
Southport, the inaugural Australian Rules Club on the Gold Coast, 21 senior men's premierships in their 61 years. They won 3 in 4 years from 05 to 08, then waited a decade for their most recent flag in 2018. That man was a part of it, Mitch Johnson. They defeated Sydney in the grand final. Steve Daniel coached that win. As we head down to Michael Barlow, Mickey, this lineup we've spoken about, we'll take a look at it now. It is stacked with mature age bodies.
That it is, Southport. You know, as you mentioned, Jase, only two players under the age of 21 years of age. And a lot of these guys off AFL list. So this moment, the VFL Grand Final won't faze a lot of these boys at all. They're looking forward to the opportunity. They've been on the plane a lot this year, and they're here to win it. And we'll have a look at the weather. There's just a slight drop of rain at the moment. A bit of precipitation, as Brownie likes to refer to it. A slight zephyr from left to right on the broadcast screen.
Two skippers in the middle of the ground. Well, the three. It's Mitch White, Jacob Dawson, Michael Manteat for the toss of the coin. D's winner. Oh, kick to the left of screen in the opening term. Casey faithful from far and wide, and Nudge indeed, the Springvale faithful. Just talk us through, for those who don't understand, the transition from the Springvale Scorpions to the Casey D's.
Well, the club's continually evolved through its 100-year history from playing in the Federal and Southeast Suburban League to joining the VFA Division 2 level in 1982, progressing to win a premiership in 83, a VFA Senior Division 1 premiership in 1987, four premierships through the 1990s, and then I guess with the change of circumstances in the local area, the move to Casey Fields was a major one back in 2006. First game there, of course, where they beat a Box Hill side that included the likes of Buddy Franklin and Grant Birchall. And as you mentioned, they've been a perennial finals team in their history out at Cranbourne.
Brownie, you've been there in this situation right now. You break from your huddle, you head to your position on the field. You know who your starting matchup's going to be. What's going through your mind?
Well, there's nerves. There's nerves because you're desperate to win. It's what you've been striving for all year and multiple years and sometimes your whole career. There's nerves that you want to play well on the big stage, on the personal level. The first contest is always a really fierce one. And as we look at the Shark Tank, I was told, Jase, during the week, over 100,000 members the Southport Sharks have. That is extraordinary.
It is a massive, massive organisation. And we were there last weekend. It is such an impressive facility. They are a very financially powerful club. They're now in the VFL. It's an attractive proposition for young men to go up, live on the Gold Coast, play VFL football, and have the opportunity to maybe get onto an AFL list. There's Clivey Boakey. Luke Dunstan's had a superb season. He'll start on Jesse Joyce. Some great midfield matchups.
Mitch White going straight to the most damaging player for the Southport Sharks.
Our first quarter, thanks to Isuzu MUX.
That is Jacob Dawson.
Four quarters to claim a piece of football history. The 2022 VFL Grand Final. The Casey Demons and the Southport Sharks.
A three-year wait for a VFL Premier. Has only 3 hours left to go. Casey and Southport to play off for the title. Crosley and Wiedemann will go at it in the centre all day. Munro will try and set the agenda early. Goes body on body with Woodcock. Crosley, hand pass, stepping through traffic. Joyce, so impressive in last week's preliminary final victory. Boakey gives the first inside 50 to the Sharks, who've got plenty of white jumpers in the screen. Johnson hunting after it. What a story he would be. Pescott in there as well. It now spits free. So the umpire's prepared to let this go. And goodness knows what those white and black Southport jumpers are going to look like in 3 hours' time, given the soggy, wet conditions here. And it remains to be seen whether we get any more rain at Icon Park this afternoon.
As the sun breaks through, socket forward. Opportunity here for Southport pressing. Townsend goes to ground. Allison collapses in over the top of him. And they're going to be rewarded. Chance for the D's to clear here through Tomlinson and Allison. And Tomlinson will get the free kick. Go long towards the city wing. Ben Ruin, Melksham has sat off that beautifully. Read the front and centre perfectly. Woden showed it to Joyce, who ran him down. Swings it wide to Baker. Likes to go with speed. Speaking of speed, Chandler in the pocket striving. Can't quite get there.
We spoke in the pregame about their efficiency going forward, and you can see why. When they get that ball out of the half back line, they spread, they use the full width of the ground, they take off, and usually they use it a little bit better than that.
I mean, this game pulled 100 minutes forward because of tonight's Brownlow medal count. Crowd descending late here at Icon Park. You can see the legend stand starting to fill up. Van Ruin at the back. Joyce will get the clearance. It's to the advantage of Buntine, who let it bounce on its point. Charlesworth after him, and Matt Buntine, one of a couple of Casey Demons previously on an AFL list. Little tummy tap there with former Giants teammate Jacob Townsend.
I thought Jesse Joyce last week was critical. 32 touches and 10 clearances, a big goal, a former son.
Sam Wiedemann, 34 years to the day since Dad Mark played in a VFA premiership for Coburg, as Baker is the one taken down. Queenslander facing up against some familiar foes this afternoon.
So the question is, Southport, can they get through this ring of steel that Casey tend to put around the stoppages? That's going to be the key this afternoon. Gowers feeds it forward. Woodcock steps the first tackle. Can't get away from the second. Dawson, he's taken down in a strong tackle by Dunstan. Umpire said it was high. So we know Brownie Casey brings the heat. They usually concede first possession, and then they just come flying
in. They, yeah, they do. And their tackle pressure was fully on display last week against Brisbane. They were absolutely fanatical in the way they approached the play with the ball.
Jacob Dawson having a phenomenal year. Second in the Liston Trophy for best in the competition. Through the hands of Manteat. Flipped out there by Tomlinson. Umpire says insufficient intent.
He got 22 votes, Jacob Dawson. So did Boyd Woodcock. Equal second.
So the ball's in the hands here of Ryan Davis. Big game performer. Been best on the ground in two grand finals. Kicks towards the top of the goal square. It's still alive. It'll be picked off by McVee. Flat kick out. He's going to come straight back. Bokey's got it.
Southport able to compress the ground here. Bokey with the repeat entry. Hands on it. Enough on it from Smith. No. Buntine also not into the back there from King.
He just did enough on that occasion, Charlesworth, to bring the ball to ground. Good bit of play. Caught behind. You get a stoppage inside your forward 50.
So the Sharks with four of the first five entries inside forward 50. Dunstan, little clearing ball. Howe sweeping onto it. Let it go. Chandler, pokey hand pass. Well presented from Turner. And he'll be surrounded by four Southport players. Daniel Turner back in the team for the last seven games. Of course, that debut at AFL level on Queen's Birthday Monday. The concussion and since the return in the VFL.
Ball security really important early in a grand final. You don't want to cough it up.
Holding his width there was Fields. Look at Woe Woden pinball off him. White entry inside forward 50. This will skid to Melksham's favour. Will it sit for him to kick the first of the grand final? Casey on the board.
Taj Woe Woden with the big win on the wing. Critical 50-50 ball here. He just body-lined it, wanted the football, bounced off. And the forward 50 entry was absolutely outstanding from White. He knew where all the dangerous space was. The Isuzu D Max replay. And once you get out the back, you're a big chance of hitting the scoreboard. Jake Melksham read that perfectly. He's had a tough couple of weeks. By Woden, he got COVID, missed last week. He got concussed in the first qualifying final from Peter Laddams. Great to see him out there.
Crosley got the tap. White got his boot in the way. Joyce goes tracking it. Garn, Dawson, Lockhart, the former D, to Crosley, and they work it through the middle to Foot. Under pressure, had to get the kick away quickly to work for Gowers. Almost within range, Billy Gowers. He'll wheel and go from 52. Gives it a ride. Can he get it there? It won't matter because Townsend's going to get on the end of it.
It's critical for his confidence, Townsend. He's had a great year leading the goal kicking for the Southport Sharks with 35, but hasn't hit the scoreboard in the final series. He's been kept relatively quiet in their two finals and just quick ball movement. It's going to catch defenders out all the time, especially if that ball holds up in the wind and drops short.
Famously played in an AFL premiership at Richmond in just his fifth game for the Tigers. This to level it up. Goal apiece in the grand final.
And boys, Boys, just down here, boundary side, the sun's popped out twice and it started raining a little bit once or twice as well. So the weather keeps changing. We're 10 minutes into the, or 7 minutes into the match, and lots happening down at ground level, but the ball is pinging around, and the ability of the Southport Sharks to use hands out of stoppage is very noticeable.
Quick ball movement, wasn't it? And some critical players involved. Foot with that kick inside 50. Billy Gowers always likes to wheel and go. Gives his forwards an opportunity.
Jacob Townsend kicked 2 goals in Richmond's VFL Premiership win the last time we were here against Williamstown in 2019. Gets the Sharks started, and the agenda has been set. This 14th VFL Grand Final here at Icon Park. Mitch White, Team of the Year on Monday night. Polled 3 votes in the Liston Trophy in rounds 3, 4 and 5 consecutively. Is Wiedemann over the top after getting a bit of a run on Crosley? A toe on it for King. It comes free, and that'll be advantage Chandler, who the slip in the end worked to try and get around Boakey. Foot, another who was so pivotal in the prelim win over the Suns. Gives them another entry inside forward 50, and but a free kick, and it's going to be a Casey ball at the origin of where the foot kick landed. It'll go the way of Daniel Turner. He's queued back to a muddy patch. You can see the entire centre part of the ground, goal to goal, quite muddy from Friday afternoon's NAB League Grand Final that was hosted here in torrential rain. Good mark at the back, and this is important. Clark for Southport off that shoulder injury last week, taking his place in the decider. Kick wide and connecting to Peskett. This is good movement here from Southport. Peskett will trot off his line. Cue the lead for Gowers. And again, casual with the mark, a la what we saw last Sunday against the Suns.
He kicked 2 goals last week and contributed, but he should have had 4 or 5. He got himself in terrific spots. Most of those were at the top of the goal square where he moved his opponent, got a running jump at it, got 2 hands to it and dropped it. On that occasion, the lead was perfect. The kick was executed well. He just couldn't hold on.
Wiedemann over the top of Charlesworth. Gunn spun in the tackle. Back to Charlesworth. Quick kick forward inside 50 off the hands of Fields. Beautiful spin move. Then run down from behind. Buntine put his head over the football and won himself a free kick. Buntine, just another of these AFL experienced players. 67 games for the GWS from 2012 to 21. And he's been a rock down back for Casey this season. High kick in the Wiedemann direction. Van Ruin there as well. Boakey off the back under some pressure from Laurie. Dunstan went hard against Charlesworth. Can Foot get into space? White won't allow it. He's immediately tackled. Releases a handball. Baker keeps it alive. Flicks it back inside for George Gray. High kick off a step. Van Ruin uses the body on Garn. Did it well.
So Casey find a way out, and I'll try and lengthen the ground again. Player down for the Sharks. 2-on-2 down the line. Brown versus Spencer. Chandler once again at the footing. Melksham with an opportunity. Kicked it straight into Clark.
Oh,
that'll test everything for Reece Clark, and he is clutching that. And you can see Matt Garn just in the bottom of shot there. He's cradling the back of the head after getting a knee. Here's the Melksham kick. Eyes inboard, and Clark wears it right in the solar plexus.
Real body on the line sort of stuff today, and that's what's going to win you a grand final.
He will be wearing the Kangaroo brand. So Wiedemann again looking to just start off Crosley. Clever from Dunstan, but the kick will favour Reece King, and he'll carve a path and find a way onto his left boot. Wide for Peskett, too wide. Chance for Casey to reset. Do you feel like Southport at the moment are the one just in that 1 metre wall winning more of the footy?
Yeah, they're winning the footy. They've had 8 inside 50s to 2, so that they're playing the game in their half. But the efficiency of Casey, which we've seen all year.
Smith's kick over the back, tidied up by Garn to Boakin. A lot of room to work with. Goes down the line. Peskett's got a couple to beat. Well done, Turner. Belts it over the top. Michael Barlow, boundary side. What have you made of the early stages on the inside?
There's a clear focus to play the outer wing as we're looking at it at the moment. That's the better part of the ground. The broadcast side is actually quite choppy, quite muddy. So a lot of these rotations, actually, the players waiting to come on have to wait a long time because there's just been no play over broadcast side.
Crosley with strength on Wiedemann. Woodcock, then Crosley off the ground. Coming out to meet it was Peskett. What a live wire he is. A real spark and character in this side. Dawson was clever. Slapped it away. Quick handball backwards from Fife. Kick under pressure will float inside 50. Tomlinson and Allison there for the Ds. Allison slaps to the line. The dangerous foot on the burst, but quickly wraps him up, takes him to the line, quickly getting the opportunity to step in for Bowie, who's ineligible to play in the VFL Grand Final. Cozzy can play that role.
We're only 12 minutes into this first quarter, already 9 inside 50s, but the thing with Southport are they're really making sure they're not allowing a Casey defender to drop off. No intercept marks at the moment for the Casey defence.
Dunstan clearing kick. Melksham trying to track back to it, as is Spencer. Brown created the contest, but again, Clark was the one standing up and pokes the kick well to Woodcock, who's had a hot start here. His seventh touch will try and provide for Pescott. Jumped at it. Charlesworth, the crumb, goes back to Pescott. He was already under pressure, rolling through Turner. Hayden Quigley, 57 in his shot there, as Jace mentioned, coming in for Jake Bowie, has laid two really significant tackles to stop the Sharks in their forward 50 so far. Wiedemann almost tried to grab it. Pescott over the top, as is Dawson.
Mickey Barlow, we don't see Casey suffer a territorial disadvantage for too long, but right now they are.
Absolutely, this is one-way traffic at the moment. The ball just mortgaged in the end of the Southport Sharks. You just feel they need to take a couple of opportunities here to put some scoreboard pressure to add to their dominance of ground position.
Big pack of players, bodies fly everywhere. Dawson off to Foot, who blasts it forward, but out of bounds on the full. Brownie, we saw this a little bit last week against Gold Coast. Southport dominated early, but it took them a long time to break the game
open. They had 74 inside 50s to 42. They were plus 32 inside 50s. It was one of the more dominant displays we've seen this year, but
they kicked 14-25.
The Gold Coast Suns, they hung around because they were efficient going inside forward 50, very similar to how Casey played.
Here's an opportunity. Fields can get onto the miss kick. Flipped over the top. Johnson versus Smith. Well done, Smith. Johnson's pressure was good. Tomlinson also under pressure. The quick release to Allison, and they will get out through Chandler.
It'll be steady. She goes at halfback, wide for Brown. VFL Premiership player with his coach today, Mark Corrigan, with the Cats in 2012. Chandler continued to stay involved in the chain. He's kicked wide, and Van Ruin, what a season he's had with 36 majors. The high draftee from the Ds, chipping ball. Laurie sold into trouble with the Spencer fist. Clever off the ground from Casey to find it forward. Maniz Wakefield lurking here, but surrounded by White again. Working in close confines is Willis. Casey players one of three. Maniz Wakefield might receive it. And a chorus right in front of the contest in the Legends stand go unrewarded, and the boos ring out. Almost halfway through the first, pulsating grand final, one straight apiece.
Crosley will go against Van Ruin. Crosley just sets the big frame, but once again, they can't get it out. Munro in there pressuring, and that is Casey football 101, Brownie. First possession to the opposition, and they just refuse to let it release.
Yeah, they have a real proclivity for tackle pressure and hard work, and I don't think we'll be calling too many more games of Jacob Van Ruin at VFL level. He's a rising star.
Bedford rolls Garn in the tackle.
Got to bring your best stuff to the grand final.
I think Brownie's got his word of the day out of the way early. Thank goodness it went well. Munro, Baker, high kick will float back towards the goal square. Two on two, some body work from Melksham. And it's going to be punished. The non-officiating umpire said it was illegal, ripped him off the football. Here's another look, Brownie.
It was a terrific hit from Oscar Baker to a really dangerous spot. You could just, not much in that. Just the hand around the hip almost forced him to ground.
Spencer to Fife. He'll go long. Wiedemann in the contest. Big contest it was. Here's Bedford with speed. Runs away from Crosley. Can he get a look? Handball over the top. Just a bit too much on it for Van Ruin.
You can see Bedford deciding whether to back himself for the kick or not. So Southport now with some work to do. They're looking for a quick out here, and that's a fantastic mark from Heron in the conditions. Set running as well. Johnson has the drop on Smith. Smith, the athleticism. Johnson, that was just so unnecessary.
Yeah, just silly spur of the moment. And they're the little one percenters. You just take that over the boundary line for a stoppage in your forward half. Allow your players to reset.
So inside 50s, 12-4 Southport. Apart from that, the glaring statistics, 15-8 handball receives the Sharks, and Casey without a mark off an opposition kick, which has been central to their DNA this season. Munro in close confines, Woden, pole-axed in the Joyce tackle and moving nowhere.
The Southport Sharks, the preparation they've come into this game, the method they want to execute, it's standing up. It's just how long can they continue to do it for.
Woodcock standing up as well to Fields. Ball in board for Lockhart. The former D off to Boakey. Will trot his way through that muddy circle and send the kick deep. Will it skid? Oh, that is amazing. Peskin, courage. Outstanding.
He ran 30 metres back with the flight of that ball and did not flinch. Pretty bold ball movement through the corridor. And that is just courage personified.
It was not in your TV screen or in our field of view until the very last second, Max Peskin.
He's got real X factor.
One of eight Sharks to play all 20 games this season. 28-21 in front of goal. Sharks have got their first lead of the grand final.
Bit of individual brilliance there. Terrific mark on the Isuzu D-Max. Look at that, Max Peskin. He's got some AFL interest. He had a really good game last week. He just didn't capitalise on his opportunity. 17 touches, one goal, three, and a couple out on the full. We remember he kicked the sealer and ran through the gate into the crowd. It was a great VFL Smithies moment.
And then ran straight to the bench and threw his guts up.
But he'll remember that one. Great goal.
2-1. Great start this from Southport. Really good contest early from both teams. Socket out of the air by McPhee. Standing underneath it and punched away from him was Maniz Wakefield. Good strong tackling work once again from Southport. Mickey, we're 19 minutes in. What's happening in the two coaches' boxes?
Yeah, Jace, from Casey's point of view, I think Mark Corrigan just wants some composed possession, get his side to find some uncontested marks. They've had a couple of chains, and that's when they've looked most dangerous. Southport have been really enjoying the speed on the ball, and they've just got to keep that speed on the ball and keep the ball hitting the deck inside forward 50 for the likes of Zach Foote and Mitch Johnson.
So Boyd Woodcock has it on the wing. Will go short inside. Joyce will step around. Melbourne player down, Casey player rather. It's Bedford looking a little sore. Delivery inside 50, thundering out. Mark will be played to Tomlinson as Toby Bedford gets to his feet in the centre square and limps.
Just getting the game played on their terms. Again, quick ball movement through the corridor. That leading lane wasn't closed fast enough and Townsend having a real presence up forward. The white tag on Dawson's going well. He's only had the three touches, Dawson, but Woodcock's getting off the chain.
I think I said Tomlinson taking the mark. I'm at Townsend against Tomlinson. And so Jacob will have an opportunity to kick his second. 45 out directly in front.
Poked at that.
And it's left off the boot.
He did not at all try and strike that hard. And it's only just got the distance in the end. So another opportunity gone begging for Southport that are dominating the territory in this first term.
Yeah, very different look to their match back in round seven at Casey Fields when it was 6-2 to nothing in the opening quarter to the home side. Brown presenting. He couldn't mark either. Now he and Chandler are forced to go in a tandem tackle.
And they kicked 6-5 after that nudge, Southport did, which gave him great confidence coming in this afternoon.
Adjusted accordingly. Premium on the start. And they're winning it at the moment in all aspects. White forward for the returning Laurie. He missed it. Willis found it. To Boakey, who's giving them fantastic drive from the back half. Penetrating left football, again looking for space. Back with the fight. Quigley has slotted into the grand final heat very nicely so far.
Their first intercept mark, though, for the quarter.
Short to Jimmy Munro. Heart and soul player of this team. Eighth season with the Ds. He's 10th in the VFL. I saw him on the way in, he and Mitch White. And I said, how are you feeling? He said, you're looking at two coiled springs. They are ready to go. They've been waiting 6 years since they lost that first grand final to get another chance. After 2018, here's Clark. Down the line for Heron. And he takes it on his chest just inside the line in front of Judd McVie. Wants to move it quickly. As we mentioned, speed on the ball critical for Southport. Drives towards the corridor. There's 3-on-2 in favour of the Ds. Allison at ground level. Townsend does some hard work on the deck. Goes in and makes sure Buntine can't get it out.
That's all you want from your forwards. Create a contest. Try and bring it to ground if you can't mark it. And create a stoppage now. You can see the Southport defenders all structuring up behind the football.
Wiedemann out of the ruck. Foot throws a foot at it. Where Worden couldn't control it. Joyce with strength tries to crash through. Foot comes charging in the other direction. Joyce tried to flip it up, and the Ds win the scramble. They'll get it to the wing.
Work to do now for Clark. He's recovered from copping the kick earlier from Melksham. Manteek to a running Willis. He'll boot it deep. Johnson sitting back here. Smith will find it. Rushed itself right into Johnson's shoulder. An unexpected mark for Johnson, who was expecting it perhaps to flick off the hands here. And again, the deep entries for Southport have been telling.
He was staying down. Smith got sucked into the contest and then allowed the ball over the back, which took Mitch Johnson by surprise. But they're getting the ball to really dangerous spots in the ground.
He's grown up in Casey's backyard, Beaconsfield, Berwick. This year with Pakenham when he hasn't been playing with Southport. Some 2.5 hours flight away. Johnson gives Southport a third.
Southport's ball movement deep inside forward 50 entries. It's really probing and testing the Casey defence here. Isuzu D-Max, you can see that travel over the back. And in 5 of the 8 quarters Casey had played coming into today, they'd only conceded 1 goal, their defence. So unfamiliar territory for Casey. They just need to regroup.
Mitch Johnson, who kicked 10 straight in a game against Aspley last year in the VFL. Wiedemann spirals it out of the ruck, inside 50. Off the hands of a contest for Spencer. He's got a couple to beat. Munro goes at it. Van Ruin will get there first. He's run down from behind. Munro picks it up, throws his boot at it, bends it back into the corridor, past Dunstan. He goes to find it. Now off to Woden, who can get a look. Can straighten up from 45. Go for home and slot it through. He's had an impressive first season, Brownie. 18th game this afternoon, averaging 15 touches a game. Missed in the health and safety protocols. Didn't play the prelim. Welcome return.
Yeah, absolutely. He's just getting better and better every time we see them play. And just had the presence of mind there to straighten up. Didn't try and hook it around the body with a snap. He knew he had the journey in his leg. Terrific reply from Casey. And again, their efficiency on display. Only 5 inside 50s for 2 goals, 1.
The Sharks 3-1 from their 17. Interesting enough, they've been able to generate all their scores so far from marks inside 50. Rain pelting down. Bedford's recovered early from that fall, pretty much in that position from where he kicks wide. Melksham hoping for a free kick, not forthcoming. Bounce was able to favour Fife. Tumbling footy gets through Townsend. Allison being worn closely and shading it to the boundary. Ryan Davis hot on his hammer. Ryan Davis getting married next Saturday. Who organises a wedding on AFL Grand Final Day? That man, Ryan Davis, the journeyman, looking for a second medal with the Southport Sharks.
That's extraordinary. Grand Final Day and Derby Day should be off limits.
Might make for a cheap reception. Gets over the back for Munro. Dawson tracks it, wins it. Fumble from Lockhart, so he just sockers it forward. Dunstan gets in the way for the Ds. He's taken down by King, and then King goes hunting Jimmy Munro as well.
Nicky Barlow was telling me a story about Ryan Davis. He was so keen to impress the Gold Coast Suns before he got there. He did a 2K time trial on a bike and pretended he ran it.
All true.
Hope I wasn't talking out of school there, Mickey.
No, all very true. And on the MC of his wedding next week as well, on Grand Final Day. So, it's remarkable. He rode a 2 kilometre track on a bike at jogging pace to convince the Suns he was their man. He was not.
Townsend, he's inside 50, and here he is right on cue.
script that.
He sent a screenshot of the run, the tracking, to his agent. Who was me.
Oh, no.
You're all involved in this conspiracy.
What did you do with it?
Passed it on to the club.
Oh, no.
He's got to go back and kick this. He knows what it takes to win premierships, this man. He's been a stalwart.
Ryan Davis, a bastion of integrity. And he misses to the right.
I'd like to say I was unbeknownst.
Oh, righto. Back over it. So it's a 7-point game. Southport 19 inside 50s to 6 have been completely dominant, but only lead by 7 points. Tomlinson with a kick in.
Sure, there's a statute of limitations for these things as Tomlinson pulls out the driver. Willis is under this. Brown was trapped at the back. It's paddled by Willis to Baker, to Chandler. Casey in a clean air. Brown had more time than he thought. Just boots it forward. It'll bounce. Track towards Tate. Sensational tackle by Melksham to get him to the line, and the reward will be halving the contest. Plenty of Ds, the hierarchy, the players looking on. Tim Lamb, Alan Richardson in the middle. Shane Woden, the bottom left of your screen there, of course, the 2000 Brownlow medalist.
He'd be happy seeing his boy already hit the scoreboard.
Suntage had a good influence so far as Wiedemann and Crosley will tangle once again. enough stoppages and five goals suggest this quarter should go perhaps north of 30. Woodcock, for the first time in the quarter, is lassoed. Free kick will go the way of the D's, and this wet, heavy footy, Jimmy Munro, perhaps not the player you'd expect who can get the full 50 and then some.
And now Jimmy Munro just paying a little bit more close attention to Woodcock, who's leading all comers on the field with 10 touches.
And they've almost been the champ on the ropes, or at least the favourite in the fight, who's just been rolling the punches, letting them hit the gloves and the shoulder in the first quarter. Be pivotal if they can bring it back to three goals apiece here. Munro deep. Van Ruin tried to push his opponents out, and the margin is one straight kick.
I think he got caught in two minds then, to chip the ball up to the top of the square or have a shot, and in the end, he just got it too close to the goal line. Easy pickings for the Southport defence.
Clark's kick is perfect to Townsend. He hits the 45 to Joyce. Good bold ball movement here from Southport. Can they go from here? D's fold back their numbers. Pescott's the short option.
Yeah, they probably don't need to play overly quick at the moment. 29 minutes gone, first quarter, and a lot of the Casey mids and defenders are just folding back.
Field's left foot is a weapon, and he'll use it to drive it long and try and get over the top to Charlesworth. Almost worked. McPhee swallowed up by Charlesworth. Umpire says holding the ball.
They get another shot here. Terrific forward 50 pressure from the big man.
And didn't he have some important moments late in the preliminary final, Dan Charlesworth? 15 possessions, 5 marks, 2 goals. They swung him forward. He had an impact in that last quarter as they made their break. And now...
needs some reward for effort.
The 24-year-old from Cairns, who spent some time at the Gold Coast Academy, plays his local footy at Surfers Paradise. He's kicked 8-3 for the season. Important kick. Again, he just sort of poked at that one, Brownie, and was always left.
Yep, and quite often, how often do we see sides that absolutely dominate a quarter? They don't put it on the scoreboard, and they rue the missed opportunities.
More behinds and goals in 8 of their last 9 games, Southport. 14-25 last week.
Munro to Tomlinson to Brown. Again, couldn't clasp it. Brings it in live, and Bedford now surrounded. The one man in white you don't want tackling you today is number 24, Braden Crosley. He's a moving fridge.
You simply just do not get 19 inside 50s against a Casey side very often. So they'll be wrapped with how they're playing, but disappointed they're not up by 3 or 4 goals.
White to Chandler. Clock ticking here if the Demons are going to square this at 3 goals apiece. Wide for Melksham. Sliding mark right on the line. He's got an option to try and pierce it through Garn. Brown will try and get to the back of Spencer. Presenting is Van Ruin. It spits free. Bedford. Brown snuck out the back here. The ball tracked the line and just made its way out to the relief of the Sharks.
Jacob Dawson, their co-captain.
That was centimetre, not perfect.
Imperfect. Crosley at ground level. Baker tries to keep it alive and can't. And Michael Barlow, the one thing we've seen about Casey this year makes them so hard to play against. When they're being dominated on the ground, they just don't concede score.
Yeah, they're hanging in, aren't they? Their backs aren't intercepting, as you mentioned, but they're not getting outmarked. There was the Johnson outmark early that resulted in a goal, but they're bringing the ball to ground. The longer the game goes, they will be able to bring in their intercept game.
Baker was ripped off the football. Munro likewise. Woodcock tries to get away from Mitch White. Munro in there scrapping again against Joyce. Umpire's going to have to call for this one. How's he going to see it? He's going to ping Jimmy Munro. Jesse Joyce, who was enormous last week. 32 touches, 10 clearances in the prelim final.
We've got a great contest on our hands. Southport, they're really up for the fight at the moment. And Casey, you know, they never say die.
Garn crosses the wing. Wiedemann used the body. Gower's handball partly smothered back into the congestion. And it is quarter time in the 2022 VFL Grand Final. Tight and tough as you'd expect. Southport have come out swinging. 19 inside 50s to 8, and they lead it by 7 points. It's the Sharks 3-3-21, the D's 2-2-14.
Seven's coverage of the VFL is brought to you by the powerful 3-litre Isuzu D-Max, born to tow. Seven's coverage of the VFL is brought to you by
Maxxis Tyres. Performance when it's wanted, safety when it's needed.
Quarter time in the 2022 VFL Grand Final at Icon Park. It was on from the start, as you'd expect. Two teams were very physical on the inside. Jake Melksham got on the board with the opening goal. Jacob Townsend responded. And from there, it was really all Southport. 19 inside 50-7. They kicked 3-3 to 2-2 to lead by 7 points at the first change. Boyd Woodcock having a huge influence early. He's had 10 touches. Tomlinson, Chandler and Munro, 7 apiece for the Ds. Campbell Brown, as we take a look at the overall numbers. And obviously, it's a sort of a double-edged sword, isn't it? If you're Southport, you're delighted with the territory, but you're looking at the scoreboard going, well, we could be further in front.
Pretty even inside, wasn't it? You look at the contested possessions and clearances, they're really even. They were slightly better on the outside. They out-tackled them, which is not something that many sides can say they have done against Casey. Dominated the inside 50 territory, and the defence held up for the Casey Demons.
Let's take you inside the Southport huddle now. Here's their coach, Steve Daniel.
You've got to keep bringing the heat. Okay. Just got to keep bringing, turning up, okay? So we've had a good first quarter, and that's what we wanted to do. Yeah. All I'm worried about is not getting blown out of the water like we did last time. At the moment, we find ourselves in front.
Come on.
Now, to be rewarded, you've got to keep working, don't you?
Yeah.
You've got to keep going and going. Okay, kicking. So when they're kicking the ball at the moment, you're defending it really well. They just don't have much on. So that tells me at the moment, we're reacting really, really quick.
Thanks to Steve Daniel as we start the second term. The 2022 VFL Grand Final. Wiedemann taken down by Crosley.
Look at the big man. That's going to be another intriguing battle. The athleticism of Wiedemann and the brute of Crosley.
We've got a Mickey Barlow shortly. He was inside the Casey huddle. We'll get a message from Mark Corrigan as Wiedemann and Crosley go at it again. Dawson with the first disposal of the second term. High towards half forward for Gowers. He's got Smith for company, who takes it to the line. Mickey, you're in the Casey huddle with Mark Corrigan. Our second quarter thanks to Maxxis Tyres.
Yeah, Mark Corrigan really challenged his players on spread. Once the ball left the contest, he felt absolutely the Southport players were getting on the outside and finding that uncontested possession, that second, third change, whereas the Casey Demons, they stopped at the source.
Yeah, uncontested possessions, one area Southport were in charge of in the opening term. Dawson, solid collision there with Woden. Jacob Dawson, 6 touches in the opening term, averaging 30 a game this season. 37, 13 clearances last week in the prelim final. He was outstanding.
Rebel Coaches MVP, awarded at the VFL Awards on Monday night. What a player he's been. Casey put another one out on the full. This time it's Dunstan who's the man to do so. Luke Dunstan with 6 in the game so far. 4 times he's had first possession for the Demons, which has been a rarity, you'd have to say. To be Jacob Dawson's 7th of the contest. Skipping kick, Wiedemann. Mark out of bounds, it doesn't matter, it'll be a Casey ball. As the sun bursts through, we've had a little bit of everything through the first quarter and a couple of minutes, conditions-wise here at Icon Park. Van Ruin spat out of it, high fly and a heavy landing there from Tate. He gets up pretty gingerly. In fact, it's Reece Clark. Another who's got a myriad of Grand Final experience, having been a premiership player and the best on ground in the Goulburn Valley League Grand Final for Kyabram some 6 years ago. White hustling through, wearing the contact to the top of the head there was Roy Woden, who kicked a really important steadying goal for Casey at the 24-minute mark after the Sharks had kicked 3 in a row to establish a 2-goal buffer.
Crosley's tap, Dunstan and White willing tacklers. And once again, we see that Casey inner circle pressure. Southport have been effective. That's been their game plan. Can they get through that inner circle, get it out into space, and then run and spread? That's their game. Shift that Melbourne defensive zone. Woodcock beaten to it by Baker. Pokes it down the line. Van Ruin crashes the pack and takes a couple with him. On the deck, Lockhart.
On the second effort.
Van Ruin gets him.
Don't you just love that from your big man? Real appetite just to hit some bodies. First the contest in the air, and then he followed up on the ground.
And there's Jay Lockhart getting up, cradling that right hand. Broken hand, had surgery prior to the preliminary final.
wearing a glove again today. Woodcock to half forward. Pescott over the top. Splits the pack. At ground level, it's all D's. Bedford has got some options. The first of which is just a play on and go himself. Tries to get it over the head of Crosley. He does. Well-weighted kick. Dunstan can run away. Deliver it low and flat inside 50. They've got numbers. Good defensive support. It's Max Spencer.
This is as far as Casey have pressed in the 3 minutes of the second term so far. Spencer, former Werribee player, clears. Gowers will find from the side. Turner had the supreme recovery. White inboard. Forced to kick off a step. It's skew-if. Brown's the one under it. He'll out-body tape. And again, works its way back to Spencer. Straight into the hands of Woden. That ball's gone 8 metres. Mark, play on. Confusion reigns. Play continues. Bedford the flyer for Casey. It pinballs around. Manteat, a kick in hope to create a foot race. Or even better, Fields. Clean half-volley pickup. Boakey will run the line on his favourite left. Bring the kick back. Only as far as Tomlinson, it rushed onto him. Clark tries to close the space down. In fact, it was King. Flying attempt to at least smother the Buntine kick, impacted its trajectory. Clark, the clearing ball, aggressive for Gowers. Southport off. They've got numbers here. Gowers with a channel to goal. Two bounces, steadies through 40, 230. Misses.
Golden opportunity goes begging.
A moment to circle the 4.5 minute mark of the second quarter. We might come back to that throughout the day.
Could have kept running and had another bounce.
Quickly to Munro. D's dodge a bullet. Can they go back the other way and land a punch of their own? It'd be a real body blow if they could get the 11 point swing. White, Wiedemann. Chance here for Dunstan. Closing fast is Heron. Well run. Jacob Heron. Forced the kick inside 50 along the ground to Melksham. Slapped away. Crosley with the strength. Smothered off his boot. D's lifting the pressure rating. Baker. Woden, no time for a fumble. Lovely pickup from Crosley. Then loses the handle. And it's taken by Tomlinson. Munro. Back inside 50. Van Ruin will stay off the contest. Can't keep it alive.
They're just hungry at the moment around the contest. They're out working. Casey, once they've won the ball and they're spreading really well, but it's the hardness in the contest that they're just showing up the best side in the competition to date. But grand final day, you've got to execute.
And who knows what's coming weather-wise still. Any lead's a good one. Munro sandwich not going to get free of Zach Foot, number two there. One of three former Casey players in the Sharks lineup. Looks like Matt Garn and Jay Lockhart. Crosley tried to flip it over the head and then pokes a boot at it, as does Baker. Boakey's been ultra clean. Dawson popped it. Heron sprints away from Dunstan, stretches down the line, and there was a good body spoil there from Joel Smith, whose dad, Sean, played in a VFL grand final for Werribee on this ground some 21 years ago. He's got the job. The similarly athletic Max Pescud. So we haven't had a goal in the game in about 14 minutes of playing time here. Joel Smith, Wiedemann will work his way to the front on Crosley, almost the mark. But again, the mop and bucket is always in Southport hands at the moment. That's an uber aggressive kick, but a beautiful one.
How bold was that?
Clark hooks up with Lockhart. They'll try and stretch Casey horizontally, and it's King marking.
Fife goes down the line. Johnson's got a couple to beat. The numbers went out. Turner used the body nicely. Tomlinson leaves it for Chandler. He's got a couple of options to the inside. Spots those now. Getting across late and almost doing enough was Willis. Advantage will be paid. Munro didn't realise, so he gave it back to Melksham. He can go towards Bedford inside 50, and all's well that ends well. Toby Bedford will get a shot.
Yeah, because the lead was on an angle. Southport Sharks defenders had folded back down the line. And you can see Jake Melksham, left footer. That's just great awareness. And knowing where the space is, Toby Bedford. Terrific football.
So Toby Bedford, 18 AFL games. He played his last AFL game in round 19 this season. 16 of them, but only 8 of them. He actually got out on the ground. He was the mini sub 8 times. He's kicked 12 goals, 8 from his 11 VFL games this season. This to make it a two-point game from 48 metres out. Drives through the kick and hammers it through.
Max's tyre replay. Toby Bedford just working into some space that they haven't been afforded too much this afternoon. His 13th goal for the VFL season. His most important because it keeps Casey in touch. How often do we see Southport golden opportunity goes begging down one end through Billy Gowers and they're made to pay down the other?
Well, they're such a high-volume team, Southport. They had double the inside 50s of Gold Coast last week but didn't put them away until time on in the last. George Gray might have tripped Dawson there. Dunstan, meanwhile, White's in trouble. Pops the handball free of Willis. Hot-stepping was Bedford. Baker, careful kick to Brown. And Casey having their best 90 seconds of the contest here. Brown just GST beyond his range. Looks for Van Ruin, who'll at least create the contest. Boakey again. Magnificent game thus far in defence.
Gutsy from Manteed as well to stand in the hole.
Wide kick will bounce. No one impacting that footy as Joel Smith will hurdle over Townsend.
Michael Barlow from a Southport perspective. A little deflating to have so much football and only be 2 points in front, but they are resilient. It's pretty familiar territory.
That's exactly right. You look at their back line. They're so mature and so connected. The ball's starting to come in. They're really standing up. Spencer, how good has Reece Clark's ball use and intercept been? He's nearly been the best man on the ground, and he's been in the wars.
Brilliant. That was his kick that got Billy Gowers released a little bit earlier when he just came busting through off halfback. Here's Boakey again. 11th touch for him. Tell you what, AFL recruiters will be keeping an eye on Kwabi Boakey. Spent a couple of years in the Gold Coast Academy, and he's a talent.
He's athletic, he's got good speed, he's a really good decision maker, and strong one-on-one down back.
Play next year as a 24-year-old and runs a 2.8520.
Croslick gets it over the back, Baker, past Johnson. Taken away from McVee. George Gray goes down, grabbing at the head as Manteet takes him to the deck.
2.85.
Yep.
That's only 0.04 off mine.
In a car.
Or Ryan Davis's bike.
Crosley over the top. Baker, look out. Run down by Townsend and rewarded.
He's making himself a real presence this afternoon. Unsighted in the final series so far this season. He wants another medallion.
Into the corridor for Johnson, over the top, not quite. Heron, immediately tackle. Casey, you've got numbers around this one. Johnson takes Bedford to the deck. And the Sharks will set up 40 metres out from their own goal. They lead it by 2 points. 11 minutes gone, second term. Great to have you with us. This is the 7 VFL 2022 Grand Final.
Sharks just their third entry inside forward 50 of the quarter. Casey have had the 7, so things have flipped territorially as Dunstan will not wriggle free. Boakey 5, Dunstan 5 for their respective teams in the quarter to date. Toby Bedford with the only goal, that coming some 3 minutes ago. Foot took him on, flicked a boot at it, it'll work backwards for Manteet. Clever from Gray. Spiralling ball be wide for Tape to try and run down. It should pitch just before he gets there. Tape, well, he geared back. It shouldn't be deliberate, you'd imagine, and that's the call from the field umpires, who we should credit. Andrew Adair, 5 grand finals under his belt. Number 2, Martin Roger, who umpired the 2019 grand final here in 15. And Matt Young, who's got 161 games of experience to his name in 16. Well done to all the field boundary and goal umpires who've got an opportunity this afternoon. Shout out to Harry Birch, the brother of Libby, of course, part of our coverage through the year, who's the emergency field umpire for the grand final as well. Woodcock, popping handball, White. Wiedemann, karate ball, Laurie did well to step, then handball awkwardly, but it worked well enough for Dunstan, who pushes it wide for Brown, who's starting to get some separation from Spencer.
Getting a little bit of space, isn't he? Because the ball movement is quicker and better from the Casey mids coming through the corridor, and a little bit of wind playing havoc. The ball's a little bit slippery. This will take Brown's absolute best, but we know he's capable.
And his third VFL grand final, a win with the Cats in 12 against Port, a loss the following year against Box Hill. What a supreme way to put Casey back in front. Campbell Brown on the Maxis Tyres replay. Mitch Brown is a technician when it comes to kicking for goal.
Just an outstanding contributor with every single club he's ever gone to and played. And 37 goals for the season, still getting it done. And doesn't that just put a dagger through the heart of the Southport Sharks when they go down one end and miss sitters and it goes up the very end and you kick goals like that?
Can Southport respond? Can they maintain the rage here? Woodcock, beautiful step. The traffic just flew by. Delivers inside 50. Was that a shove from by? I said play on. Fields in there scrapping. Munro on the bottom of that pack. Ball not coming out anytime soon. Charlesworth against Valentine. Free kick to the youngster. 20-year-old from Surrey Park. It's one of the clubs that Steve Daniel coached way back when. These days he's in charge at Southport. This is Oscar Baker at left half back.
He's done some important things, Baker. Coming up for disposal, number 11.
Moniz Wakefield went early. Off the chest of Clark. Taken by Dunstan. Having an influence. Pumps it long to a one-on-one. Bokey with some work to do here against Chandler, and he does it with aplomb. Playing one heck of a first half.
It'd be a tough matchup, Bokey, because he's got the height to play on the talls, but agile enough when the ball hits the ground.
Mickey Barlow, the rain, as hard as it's been all day.
Yeah, it's coming down a little bit now, and the umbrella's gone missing, so that's a bit of a problem. But both teams at the moment trying to play their speed players close to goal. Melksham one end, Peskett at the other.
Bokey's handball cut off. Lockhart thumps it long out towards the wing. The mark taken by Turner as we hit boundary side to Mitch White. Mitch, thanks very much for your time. What have you made of the first quarter in a bit?
She's hot out there, definitely, despite the rain. It's just probably getting a few better looks for us. I think we spent a lot of time back half, so just surge your ball forward and lock that ball in is going to be key for us, especially now that this rain's starting to come down again.
Mitch, the first quarter was relatively even in terms of clearances and contested possessions, but Southport seemed to get you on the outside a little bit. Was that addressed at quarter time?
Yeah, definitely. Obviously, we don't want to play that way, and we rectified it, I think, so far, and just surging that ball forward, maybe trying to play a bit too dry weather footy and just get the ball on boot and give our forwards a chance. I think we're getting pretty good looks every time we go forward, so the more we get in there, the better.
You started on Jacob Dawson. Is that going to be a match-up for most of the afternoon when you can?
Yeah, unfortunately for him, mate, I'm going to be in his back pocket most of the day. So, yeah, I'll see what I can do there and see if the boys can get the job done.
Mitch, thanks very much for your time in the middle of a grand final. Best of luck.
Thanks, fellas.
Mitch White joining us. The access from Mitch and the players right throughout the year from all the clubs has just been brilliant. Stepping out in the middle of a grand final to take some time to chat to us.
Captain, probably one of the most important jobs on the ground, and he comes off for a breather and speaks to us. Great work.
And see, couldn't get boots a ball. Bokey, handball that he might almost go and run down himself. He'll at least try and pressure Gray here. He's spun the full clock face and then some by Manteed it. Came back to Foot, who kicks it high up into this torrential rain. Buntine was ready to fly. Gowers did, almost marked. Off the ground, Woodcock inboard, hand on it though, from McVeigh once, twice to keep it alive. It's Joyce kicking without looking. One-on-one deep, Peskett and Turner. Peskett had a little hand on the Turner jumper, almost got to the drop of the ball.
Now this rain is getting heavier and heavier. How important would a 2 or 3 goal lead at quarter time have been for Southport had they taken their opportunities?
They've got one here. Can they manufacture something from close range? Fields goes in the ruck. Clever little tap from McVeigh was brilliant to Tomlinson. He knew he was going to get taken. Bad bounce for Lockhart. Might work for Moniz Wakefield, who's struggling to get into the game. Fife. Lockhart inside 50. Can they get on the end of it? That's the Casey defence at their best. And Adam Tomlinson.
Because they're scrubby forward 50 entries and they're not as deep as we saw in the first quarter, which just bring guys like Tomlinson and Buntine into the game.
Peskett tries to get across but can't cut the kick off before it reaches Dunstan.
This game absolutely getting played on Casey's terms now.
13th touch for Luke Dunstan. Leads the game for the D's. Towards half forward, Charlesworth the fist, but Woden the front and centre. Can use Munro, who's going to have to get rid of it quickly, and does in the process. Turns it over to Max Spencer.
Just an overhandball there from Woe Woden. He looked up, he saw space, and sometimes that's a good option on a wet day.
Casey with the last three in the game. Two straight to a behind in the quarter. That behind, the miss by Billy Gowers at the 4.5 minute mark when he had a saloon passage to goal. Munro, the blue collar has flipped and he's put it in the hands of Chandler. Spares back here for the Sharks. You can see the deepest player there loose is Willis. But there's got to be a spare somewhere for Casey. Valentine, White back into the action, will use his left boot and size it onto the chest of Bedford, who straight away points the big thank you. White, exquisite use.
Just really composed possession there. First, Chandler, who took the mark on the flank. He looked up. He didn't see any options he liked. Back into the corridor. And just a good understanding of where the leading lane was. Mitch White, the skipper, executed it perfectly, and he's looking for his second for the quarter.
Casey have 19 marks to 5 in the quarter after it was 20-13 Southport's way in the first. Bedford to become the first multiple goal kicker of the grand final. Can't finish it off, and you can hear that rain clicking through its gears.
Michael Barlow, from a Southport perspective, what discussions are being held in the box right now?
Yeah, they're looking for half-time, aren't they? They've probably still got 10 minutes to get to half-time. What Casey have done really well is, when they've got composed possession, they just haven't blasted it forward. If they had the opportunity of finding an uncontested mark, they've done it, whereas Southport have just gone fully surge and kicked the ball long.
Clark's kick to the wing, off hands to Townsend, who kicks towards half-forward. Munro paddles to the line, umpire says...
I mean, the greatest thing, if you're a Southport player, you know that the momentum is against you at the moment. You look up at the scoreboard and you go, hang on a second, we're only 5 points down. So they're still right in this contest. They've just got to correct a couple of things in the way that they've been playing in that first quarter to get back to that.
Crosley trying to take it out of the ruck. Difficult with the wet football. Munro goes for territory. Melksham was having his jumper held. Doesn't matter. He took the mark. In front of Garn. Where Woden cruises past. Melksham chips it into space. Their ball use in this second term has been outstanding, and Mitch White in best position.
It's almost like they want to go through Mitch White as well to force Dawson to defend the other way.
White pins the ears back, thumps it long. Wiedemann over the top, couldn't quite. It's still there for the Ds. Where Woden will be wrapped up and taken aground by Fife. Ball up 20 metres out from the Casey goal, which Sam Wiedemann so close.
Yeah, slippery ball. They're going to be hard to one grab.
Crosley will go against Wiedemann. He does it beautifully down to Fife, who couldn't take it cleanly, but he's got some support. And Dawson will happily take it towards the line. Woodcock will get a little bit of extra territory. And in these conditions, oh, gee, that's harsh.
Very
that's
harsh.
That's really harsh. What's his other option?
Well, the other option was to take the tackle and be tackled over the boundary line.
But the whole point of it, the rule is to keep the game moving, right? Not have it out of bounds.
And that's a lack of feel for the game as well. Chandler for White. We'll park that conversation there with Mitch White virtually ambing. Two-thirds of the players on the ground in front of him. He looks for a pocket of space. Lockhart, a brilliant mark in the conditions and with a broken hand under that glove on his right hand. Wiedemann can set himself out body by Gowers. Buntine stayed down. High was pescured, and that was spotted immediately. So Matt Buntine, he's got a player loose wide. It's Chandler, who stayed pretty much where the deliberate out-of-bounds free kick was before. Okay, Chandler, so clever typically. Cuts the kick. Wants Brown. Almost had him as well. Lockhart with his second opportunity to clear. And here's Wakefield, the pressure. Oh, super commitment. Chandler and Wiedemann. And Chandler, the smaller man, able to grab it.
The D's really turning the screws here. Can they land a couple of punches before half-time? It'll spill over the back of the contest. Manteep links up with Tate. Little handball over the top from Clark. Gives a look to Valentine. He's tackled by Manteep. It spills to Laurie. He throws a boot at it. Floats it goalward. It's across the face.
They just over-handball. It's a really wet conditions. They should have just blasted that ball out 50 metres and... Instead, two, three loopy handballs over the tops, just asking for the pressure.
They just can't get it out. 15-7 inside 50s in this second term. Well done, Tomlinson. Got it to ground. Manteep goes off the deck. Maybe a chance. Foot couldn't get free. Manteep goes to ground. Laurie's now got to do the chasing work on King. Uses the support. Pescott slips as he kicks it. Gets it to Gowers. Wants to try and get away from Allison, but in the process threw it. Well done, Corey Allison. Wants to prove it back the other way. Three on two in favour of
Southport, and a free kick in the contest. High contact. It's going to come back to Reece King, playing his final game, at least for the moment, for Southport. He's off to Canada to work in the snowfields.
Inboard for Garn. He's got overlap if he wanted to continue to come, but will hold the same line for Fields, who dropped the mark, but we know the sort of kick he is. And again, mega purchase on this kick. It'll pitch and bounce out, but it's the first time that Southport see a deep forward 50 entry in a long, long time in this second quarter.
A pretty good result there, that it bounced out of bounds instead of through from behind. Now they should just aim at locking this ball inside their forward 50 for the next 3 or 4 minutes. Get some repeat entries and try and conjure up something from the stoppage.
Well, the goal would tie it. It's through Peskett. Fields, where's the team tackle of Ellison and White? Corey Ellison shifted to defence. One of three Casey players with Baker and Munro to play all 19 games this season. Local boy grew up playing his junior footy with Cranbourne. Peskett, free kick. Oh, it's Dawson, and it's let go as well. Holding the footy. And
standing up.
Whistle is on a knife edge.
It's exactly why they brought that new interpretation in. That is outstanding umpiring. Perfect decision. He felt for it. He let it slip high.
Tomlinson to a big pack of players at halfback. Wiedemann comes crashing through. Baker on the deck. Gets a bit of territory. Melksham versus Willis. Support comes from Clark. Mickey Barlow mentioned he's kicking. There's another dart.
He's been so bold with his ball movement.
Fife this time has it in the corridor. He's called to go. So he'll kick it to half forward. Gowers will arrive. Worked under it by Smith. The dangerous foot at ground level. Here's Charlesworth off to Dawson. Pokes to the pocket. 2-on-2. Lovely kick. Peskett couldn't hang on. And Allison will come away again. That kick under pressure. Out of bounds on the full. So Southport have stabilised the situation. Brownie got some repeat entries inside 50. And now the man with that weapon of a left boot, Tom Fields, within range.
And the Casey should have been aware that he's about the only Southport player on the field that's got a leg to get the journey here in this driving rain. They just left him on his own, and this is an extremely difficult kick, but let me tell you, he could put this into the fifth row.
They don't get much harder than this. The rain is coming across his right shoulder, and it is belting down. Right behind this kick, Tom Fields will just set it up. Give them a chance at the top of the square. Front and centre is Townsend. Can he track back onto it? He can. Needs some support. The finish is beautifully smothered by Chandler. Off the boot of Tate. D's arrive in numbers to try and shut this down. Can it spill out in Foot's direction? King, here is Foot. Rides the first. Gets taken in the second. Gets a free kick for that high shot.
What a quarter Kate Chandler is having at the moment. 14 touches at both ends of the ground. He was the man that made the smother. And that was one that started high and didn't slip high. So while it's quite a soft free kick under the circumstances, that one is more likely to be paid than the Dawson one earlier.
So finishing has been one of the areas of Zach Foote's game that he's working on. He's kicked 12-16 for the season. This to tie it up. Long runner, deliberate approach. Gets to 45, gives it a ride, but hooks up left. And it is a five-point game.
Only just snuck in from behind as well. So good opportunity here for Southport to set up this defensive wall and lock the ball in their forward half until at least the halftime siren sounds.
12-17 for Foot for the season. We're 14 minutes without a goal in the game. The man to kick the last one was Mitch Brown as Turner marks. Casey looking to connect. Turner will head in the direction of Brown, who again finds some space. Had that mark all to his own, but just the mere presence of Woodcock could pressure the veteran out of it. So ball gets to halfway. Luke Dunstan will check back in the middle of your screen for this stoppage, and he's a crucial addition. He's had 13, Chandler 14 for Casey. Tomlinson also with 13 alongside Munro and White. Wiedemann got the tap, slipping foot at a crucial stage. Chandler's been important to Mitch White, looking for Van Ruin, and did well. Was ready to put the hands out, instead let it drop into the stomach. Jacob Van Ruin trying to do the Mitch Brown impersonation from the opposite flank here.
Half the time late in a half on a wet day like this, it's just about taking the 30 seconds so your midfielders and everyone can recover.
A monumental kick Dylan Moore kicked the goal at halftime in the 2018 Grand Final to keep Box Hill in the game against Casey. Jacob Van Ruin with a goal here would give Casey their biggest lead of the day. An incredibly tough kick. A pretty good effort. The Grand Final is evenly poised. Casey with a one straight kick lead at halftime.
2-3 in that term from the Casey Ds to 2 behinds from Southport. One of them a golden opportunity missed by Billy Gowers running in on open goal. And Southport's 7-point halftime lead has been turned into a 6-point halftime lead for the Ds. 4-5-29, Southport 3-5-23 at the major break in the 2022 7 VFL Grand Final. Chandler with 15 touches, White 14 for the Ds, while Woodcock's had 16 to lead the game for Southport, and Boakey's been outstanding off halfback with 13 possessions.
The outstanding half of football. Clearly the first quarter was all Southport. Quarter time came around, Casey changed some things up. They got to work and dominated that second quarter.
Michael Barlow is down on the ground with D skipper Mitch White.
Yeah, we've got Mitch White again. So that changed from Q1 to Q2. What was the message from Mark Corrigan? What changed Q2 to Q1?
I think just stop mucking around with a bit because our forwards were on top. We felt getting good looks when we get quick inside 50s. If we start mucking around with it, get one too many handballs, their pressure's really good. So just bypass their pressure, get it forward.
Yeah, and a bit more dominance around the stop. Is that extra number up and get that number around and get the ball in your half?
Yeah, a bit of density clearly with the wet weather. It's going to be bobbling around a bit. So we want to be able to cover that inside the stop and outside and get it forward.
Yep. Beautiful. Thanks for joining us, mate. Good luck for second half.
Thanks to Michael Barlow. Thanks to Mitch White. It is halftime. The grand final is evenly poised. It was Southport by 7 points at the first change. It's Casey by 6 at the half. Casey 4-5-29. Southport 3-5-23. Halftime in the 7 VFL grand final for 2022. Welcome to our 7 VFL Thirsty Camel halftime show. Thanks to Thirsty Camel Bottle Shops. It was Casey trailing by 7 points at quarter time, but they kicked 2 unanswered goals in the second term. 2-3-2 behinds as they started to take control, and they've worked their way to a 6-point lead at the major break. Casey 4-5-29. Southport 3-5-23. Halftime in the 2022 7 VFL Grand Final. Jason Bennett alongside Campbell Brown. And Brownie, in that opening term, Southport managed to control the game, 19 inside 50s to 7, and they did it off the back of getting it from the inside to the outside. Casey then managed to stop that in the second term, and they flipped the inside 50s around.
Yeah, they were really bold with their ball movement, and I think one of the things that helped Casey slow them down and prevent them from doing that was the rain. The rain came, but certainly they made some adjustments at quarter time, and they slowed down Casey, the Southport, with their ball movement, won the ball back with some intercept marks, which we didn't see in the first term, and got their game going and locked the ball in their forward half.
Our halftime highlights brought to you by the 3-litre turbo diesel Isuzu D-Max. And one thing we know about both these teams is they're incredibly resilient, mentally tough. When the game isn't on their terms, they don't panic. They just stick to their process for four quarters.
Well, you have to, and that's why they're here on grand final day, because it's a marathon, these VFL seasons, and not everything goes your way. You've got to deal with suspensions, injuries, form slumps, and they've got a lot of really experienced players that understand momentum in games, and I don't think either coaches or players will be panicking too much at the moment at the halftime.
Southport had the early going, Casey didn't panic. Casey then had the going in the second term and dominated, and it did just feel like maybe they got on top a little bit more than Southport did when they were in control.
Yeah, and look at a couple of the great goals that they kicked, Bedford and then Brown, and goals that some players might miss. Certainly some Southport players were missing up the other end. They go down, they do what they always do, execute. Unbelievable efficiency inside 50, Casey, all year.
Grand finals often come down to key matchups, and one we've been watching this afternoon is Mitch White versus Jacob Dawson. We take a look at our Max's Tyres best player in heavy traffic. Mitch White doing a great job.
This is an absolute beauty, this matchup. Dawson's had 10 touches. He's done some nice things, but Brown is working the other way. Sorry, Mitch White is White, working the other way. 14 disposals, 9 tackles. He's had 6 inside 50s, though, so he's clearly getting to work the other way. And I reckon Casey have made a real point to use him forward of centre on occasions and say to Dawson, hey, you've got a tagger, but if you're not going to work both ways, we're going to use him to our advantage.
It is halftime in the grand final. It's Casey by 1 straight kick. Back with more right after this from Icon Park. So I never forget what the feeling's like on a
down the wing. Otavi! Mark of the year! Sensational fly from Joel Otavi.
It's Korda. Kicks to centre half forward. Stack sets himself!
Oh my God.
Mark of the year right there.
Brakes are running five straight. We're in the inside 50s as Coughlin sails into the conversation.
Into the pocket they go. The big fly! Oh, Boyd Woodcock.
There's a chance for Beg to give it off to Callum Brown. High kick inside 50. Big fly from Chuck. What a grab.
He hung there forever.
He almost got a little bit of a lift off from the Casey defender.
That is a hanger and a half from Isaac Chuck. Have a look at this. Our Thirsty Camel halftime show continues. It is halftime in the grand final for 2022, the VFL grand final. It is Casey by 6 points. Well, last Monday night, we celebrated the high achievers of VFL season 2022 with our VFL VFLW awards night, hosted by the one and only Nigel Carmody. Nudge, talk us through the winners.
It was a special night, Jace, particularly in the fact that we saw Tom Gribble become the ninth man to win two JJ Liston trophies and go back-to-back in the ward after he won it in 2019. He receives it from his coach and part of our team today, and Michael Barlow. And what a remarkable season Tom Gribble's had after winning the award in 2019. Eight best on grounds, and he averaged four more possessions per game this year to lead the league with 33 touches of the game. That doesn't indicate how close the count was. At round 11, Ryan Clark from the Swans, who looks set to play in an AFL grand final next Saturday, he and Rhys Matheson from the Lions led the count. Gribble with best on grounds in rounds 12 and 13 thereafter was never headed.
Came rattling home. So wonderful performance from Tom Gribble, wins his second JJ Liston, and a really emotional one.
It was. He lost his father, Andrew, who spent time on the Geelong AFL list in late 2020, and it was something he spoke about on stage at Crown on Monday night.
Just want to go out and do him proud each game. His old thing was, or old saying as a junior, was to play each game as if it's your last, and that's what I try and do, try and leave it all out there. So, yeah, he was a good man. I think I mentioned him last time I was up here, and unfortunately we don't have that banter anymore in regards to who was the better footballer, but I'll give him that right for now. So, yeah, no, he was a good man and a good footballer.
Certainly making his dad proud, Tom Gribble, and it was no surprise, of course, that he was a key part of the VFL Team of the Year. The new addition this year, the fact that we had AFL players eligible for the first time, a number of those layered through the squad. Ethan Phillips from Port Melbourne at fullback there, the Fothergill Round Mitchell medalist this year as the most promising young player in the competition. Hopefully he'll continue the lineage of players going to the AFL.
Last 15, I think, have been elevated to AFL list shortly after. Half-time here at Icon Park. Casey by 6 points, and as we gear up for the second half, let's take a look back at our top five VFL goals of the year.
Clark sits up for Cumberland. On the left, can he shape it back? That is sensational. That's a major that was worth the wait.
Wow. Takes it out of the ruck cleanly and then hammers it inside forward 50 again, looking for a teammate to pull forward. Martin Ortega, that ball might not have been touched, and it's gone all the way for a goal.
Durden sets himself, elects not to mark. Danger here, it's Coleman, he links up with McDowell White. He bends it to a dangerous spot, it floats across, and it floats through. Wonderful goal.
Goes forward again. Contest with Wienering at ground level. Trying to go one way, then the other. Broke the tackle from outside 50. Goes to Dacos style snap. It's going right to the line. In fact, it's going through. How's the bounce from Matt Wienering?
Podaschke and Morrison. Podaschke with a clear height advantage and wins the hit out easily. Barling elected to take the tackler on, but it's worked out well for them. Penrith will escape through defensive 50, finds Velisaris and now Jones. They're all out here now. The Bullance, Murphy's got Penrith again. Penrith who's run all the way from defensive 50. The defender for an unlikely goal. And that's a beautiful goal from the Bullance.
Seven's coverage of the VFL is brought to you by INC Sports Nutrition, powering tomorrow today from Chemist Warehouse.
Second half almost set to go here. Casey by 6 points. Michael Barlow, boundary side. That cup might fill with water.
Yeah, it's just started raining again. Whole half time it was okay. It's just started to rain again. Premiership quarter. This is what's up for grabs.
Let's get set for the second half. Thanks to Chemist Warehouse, INC Sports Nutrition, Nigel Carmody to get us underway in the third term of the 2022 VFL Grand Final.
Casey with the last three of the game after Southport kicked three in a row themselves. Their biggest lead, 12. This is Casey's equal biggest lead so far. Dunstan will favour Baker. In fact, he might try and become the option for Woden, who put it wide. Baker again, just a little bit slow a couple of times today, Oscar Baker, and he plays the game at such high speed and intensity, but he's had a couple of moments. He was run down at halfback at one stage as well to give away a free kick as Willis's ball will drop short. Buntine got a fist onto it. Woden was in there. Joyce did well to shape the ball into his left foot. Pescad tangled it with the feet. Charlesworth, it comes free for Crossley. And they work it in number order as Joyce's kick smothered. Players adjusting to the greasy conditions to start the third here. Woden in there again.
And Jimmy Munro was the man that laid that smother. Desperation.
Dawson, not surprisingly, the man to make sense of it. Off to Woodcock. Spare back at Smith. And he marks for Casey.
And that's what they do so well. And now they get their offensive game going. Look at the space.
Puts it down in front of Chandler, who's been outstanding. 16th touch. Leads the game for the D's. Howes is involved. His first touch of the grand final. Kick down the line.
What a kick.
It's perfect for Melchin.
That was to perfection in between three Southport Sharks defenders and the boundary.
Melksham, low and flat. Woden lost his footing and apologises as Mackenzie Willis takes an uncontested grab.
He hasn't gone back behind his mark.
Willis out towards Manteet's got to stand and wait as Melksham comes over the top. Can King keep it alive? He can cleverly. Quick hands Davis, Joyce, King dispossessed. McPhee pings around towards Dawson, who does well to spin and pick it up but can't get away from Blake Howes. Michael Barlow. Breeze looks to be, if you judge it from the rain, going from right to left. Would that be correct?
Yeah, so it's been fairly blustery today, Jay. So it's kind of swung around a couple of times. Right now, as you're looking at it, right to left. I just want to make a note on Kate Chandler. He's the one that Casey sent up to the stoppage, and he's getting off the chain big time. So Southport will have to look to do some, put some work into him.
Mick, I'm not sure if you can get eyes on it from your vantage point, but it looked like Ryan Davis elected to bring himself off the ground to change the matchup. In defence, he had been standing Melksham for the first minute of that quarter as Wiedemann kicks clear. Chandler again, lightning in a bottle, but out of room. Okay, Chandler scratching away, knocking at the door of more AFL footy. As Jace mentioned in the first half, 10 AFL games, but Medisub, 8 of 9 across the last two seasons, 5 times unused in those matches. But he's been all class at VFL level for Casey. Wiedemann to the front for Munro, who wants to trap then kick. Thinks his way through it, pushed across the line. Umpire lets it go. Chandler the smother and then a hand in on it for Joyce.
Mickey Barlow down in the two coaches' rooms at halftime. What do you think the messages would have been, firstly at Casey?
Yeah, Casey would have been really happy with the turnaround in contest and ground position of the second quarter. So it's just rinse and repeat. Own ground position, get the ball from clearance and put it into your front half. Southport really needed the halftime break just to steady, compose himself. SJ Daniel, he's been to 15 grand finals, so he would have straightened them up and let them rip for this third quarter.
How do they get momentum back?
Yeah, they've got to get their hands back on the ball around the contest again. So Chandler is that extra. At the moment, Mackenzie Willis is dropping off. Do you send him up? They're not doing that. So I'd like them to equalise around the ball and turn it into more of a scrap at stoppage.
Chandler got another handball in there. Johnson from behind gets into the back of his D's opponent. Umpire says out of bounds.
And that's the exact thing that Mickey was talking about. So Chandler goes up to the contest. They have a plus one. It helps Casey win it. And on that occasion, his direct opponent, Mackenzie Willis, was dropping off. He impacted with the tackle there. So it's just a game of roulette at the moment.
Crosley versus Wiedemann. Dawson hit it at speed. And then a lovely tackle by guess who? Kate Chandler.
This is played one of the best first halves I've seen him play. Not just offensively, but he's doing all the defensive things well.
To the top of the square, Brown coming through his gun, leaves it behind in the slot. Van Ruin tries to find it. Spencer taken down in a tackle by Dunstan.
So the Sharks had Willis back as the spare on that Chandler kick, and this is probably the muddiest patch alongside the centre circle that you'll find on Icon Park this afternoon. So heavy work for the players to get through here. Van Ruin wants a run and a lift off Crosley, and the hand went into the shoulder. Manteat to take the advantage. It will be paid, and there's a fairly vacant forward half of the ground for the Sharks, but a lot of Casey players folding back. And even better, they'll get a stop in their half. Free kick, Allison. And Corey Allison, that's what's in front of him. Again, prepared to kick for the contest. It's off the line. Crosley's under it. Melksham flies. It might beat everyone here, but it'll track its way to the right-hand side. A let-off for the Sharks. Casey with their biggest lead of the grand final.
Yeah, it wasn't touched from that pack too, so if it had skidded through, it would have been a goal.
There's Clark with the kick in. Heads to the City side. Thumping left boot. Buntine actually came across and spoiled it away from Tomlinson then. So the D's in control right now. It was all Southport in the opening term. 19 inside 50s to 7. Casey got it back on their terms in the second quarter, and now it's up to Southport to switch the momentum back their way again. Heron. Joyce. Kick intercepted. High ball back inside 50. Brown uses the body. Van Ruin can't get away from Willis. Gives it off to Munro. He throws a boot at it. What a goal let it be! The Moose is loose! Brownie, some goals are worth more than just 6 points.
Absolutely. To strike first after half-time. And one of their experienced players, he hit the scoreboard in the qualifying final against Sydney with a couple of goals, and that was just an absolute beauty. Ball skidded on, put himself in the right part of the ground there, the feedback handball position, and the INC Sports Nutrition, he absolutely loved it.
Mark Choco Williams, part of the Melbourne coaching staff, watching on Jimmy Munro, a.k.a. the Moose. He won the last two Gardner Clark medals as Casey's best and fairest, playing in his third grand final for the club. And Casey have had 5 inside 50s to 1 in the quarter, and you can see White and Dawson continue to go at it behind the umpire at this bounce. And Dawson used the umpire for a screen. Dunstan went off the ground after foot had slipped. Kick clear from Davis. Buntine into the back of Lockhart. King at the drop. Did well to get a boot on it for Crossley, who lost his footing. Charlesworth looking for a handle. As was Dunstan. Tomlinson, composed possession. Happy to take the stoppage. And it's an interesting watch here for Casey. And even looking at their team coming in, Brownie, was how young they are at the bottom end. You've got Quigley, Valentine, Howes and Maniz Wakefield. They've only had a handful of possessions between them. Little influence in the conditions as Fields' kick is smothered. And George Gray will get plenty of pats on heads from what he did there.
That time in front graphic was quite extraordinary. 27 minutes 58, 27 minutes 54. There it is there. There has been nothing in this.
But it was all Southport early inside 50. That's where the majority of that territory comes from, and all Casey since.
They lead by 13 points. Time is now for Southport. They need to respond here before the game starts to slip through their grasp.
You just get the feeling, Casey, they're enjoying their matchups defensively now. They feel like they've got it going. The ball movement's slower because of the rain.
Jay Lockhart really battling through that broken hand bravely. You can see he's in enormous pain, though. Max Spencer taken to the deck. He's wrapped up. Umpire comes in, calls for the football. But, yeah, we spoke to Jay Lockhart before the game last week. We said, could you jab it? He said no, because where it is on the hand, can't afford to. Just got to grind it out. It's very padded up. It's all strapped. But he looks to be in excruciating pain at the moment, so credit to him for fighting on. Townsend, clever handball to Dawson. Southport will keep on coming. We spoke about their resilience earlier, Brownie. They'll stick to their process. They've just got to find a way to get back on top.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's just the slippery wet ball is going to make it hard as the game goes on to be bold with your ball movement.
Crosley, they need him to really be dominant on the inside as Chandler got first possession.
Where's the spark going to come from? Is it going to be Lockhart against his old side? Townsend, he's been a presence up forward. Is it going to be Billy Gowers for
right,
Southport?
Down to Baker, who was tackled by Townsend, but not in possession.
Trying to be physical and exert some influence and just got that a little bit wrong.
Crosley leading the hit-outs, but that's not
translating into first possession?
Well, 25 Crosley, 21 Wiedemann. I think Mark Corrigan and his coaching staff take that at the beginning of the day.
Definitely.
And it's seven hitouts to advantage to five Crosley v Wiedemann. So that, at the moment, is certainly something that's been neutralised. Right on cue, Crosley, kick wide, but Buntine, Casey's intercept game is slowly but surely kicking into gear here. Margin 13 is Buntine. Brown, Van Ruin off the head. You can hear the crowd dying with him. Bokey corralled by Chandler, who's playing both sides of the ball. Laurie the turnover to Chandler. Can Woden keep the play alive? He's got Brown on by hand. Elects to kick to Brown. Impossible ball to try and get through. And he almost crossed it off Hauser's boot there. Mitch Brown getting inventive. Kicked an incredible goal. A set shot to put Casey in front at the 13-minute mark of the second.
Ryan Davis with a kick in. Southport just hanging in here as Casey rained the blows. Goes straight up the middle. Can Crosley get on the end of it? He can. He was taken down. He'll get a free kick. Maybe some quick ball movement now for Southport. The rain has stopped. That'll help them. Oh, he's called to go. He stepped across the mark and now he's gone. Little moments like that just so important. And George Gray was a wake-up to it.
Stayed involved in the game mentally.
Gray kicks to Van Ruin. Off hands. Bokey as the rain comes thundering down again. Oh. He fumbles under pressure. Davis kick towards Lockhart. And Jay Lockhart now. Looks like he's got a cramp in the leg at the busted up hand. Yet he fights on. Nice kick down the line. Lovely mark of the conditions from Tom Fields. He'll get it and go. Can get penetration on this kick. Will go long towards Townsend. Going to have a couple to beat in the air. Where's the crummers for Southport? Quickly taken down. King gets there first. He's under pressure. Munro lays the tackle on foot. Pins the arm. And holds it up.
And the Casey defence worked that well there, Brownie. They had that ball. They only wanted it to come to the front. They were never letting it through as we see Lockhart running.
In the first quarter, that kick was going into the corridor and they were getting some space, but he simply can't pull the trigger on that kick now with the rain.
Wiedemann just gets boot to ball. Coming in, Maniz Wakefield, a fresh area from Laurie. Pressure, Maniz Wakefield, handball, Spitz, Munro to the outside. Dunstan, they link up. Chandler, a rare mistake, but time and space to keep it alive. Trying to scoop it was Dunstan. They'll take the territory. Wearing the tackle, Spencer. Clark's kick was pressured. Working towards Woodcock. Now it's five. And everything is going up. The game's heat doesn't match the temperature right now.
Just a surge game now.
Foot over his head. Hoping, finding a white jumper. Gowers again losing the handle.
The two things that are critical, the sides that are the cleaner are going to really stand out and continue to surge. And the side that is the most desperate, that is prepared to put the most heat on the ball carrier and turn it over. This game is just going to be a war of attrition now.
Charlesworth works to the front on Valentine, who got the tap. Munro in there with the tackle alongside Ryan Valentine, the 23rd man. And it is now officially as heavy as it's been all day. It is absolutely bucketing. If you can see the rain on TV, that means it's really bad. Because normally, it can be pouring rain and you don't even see it. But this is Paul Pios, Waverley Park sort of stuff without the hail. Jesse Joyce. Towards half forward. It's going to be a simplification process now. Just going to keep it really simple. Dawson couldn't take it. Willis, he's taken down. Bokey in there. Fights on against Laurie. Valentine commits his body. Pass Woden. Dawson taken down by Munro.
The contest method's still going to be really important around the structures, not all getting sucked to the football. You still need to have some players, your wingers, your quarterback out so no one can run through the front of the stoppage.
Chandler dispossessed. Dropped the football. The chance here for Southport by Woodcock. Feels like they need to score next.
Woodcock. Valentine was almost the flyer in the end. The fist came from Woden, who kicked that second goal for Casey, which bookended the Jake Melksham goal. Michael Barlow and Peter O'Connor, our intrepid floor manager, earning their keep on
the glitz and glamour of 7 VFL.
Boundary. You mentioned the weather. Well, Southport have had to resort to training on hockey fields in the car park at the Mantra at Southport Sharks given the deluge that Northern Australia's copped right throughout the year. And, well, we've been to Casey Fields a few times when it's been like this, so it's familiar climbs for their squad. Kate Chandler, only player on the ground north of 20 possessions. He's 21st, not his best. Given the benefit of the doubt.
Yes, so finesse football's out the window now. You don't want to be trying to hit up leading targets, short 50-50s. You want to take ground, kicking long down the line, which becomes quite predictable, and it plays into the hand of the Casey defenders.
Blake Howes checking back in, a hand on it for Munro. Gray wears heavy fire. The bump from Willis, clearing ball. Davis hated it off the boot, out of bounds on the full immediately. And South Porter without a goal since Mitch Johnson at the 23-minute mark of the first quarter. Casey with the last four majors of the game.
Allison steps off his line, hoists it towards half-forward. Brown to get a contest, got both hands to it. Spill to the back for Dunstan, a soccer off the ground. Brown was good to finish up. Kicks to a dangerous position here. Sliding in and taking it to the line was Fife. Under pressure from Oscar Baker. These fans feeling good about things right now. Their side leads by 14 points. As Nudge mentioned, they've been able to throw a blanket over Southport's attack since the opening term.
Van Roo might be able to use his height here to take this out of the ruck.
Charlesworth engages. Foot, a little fumble. Awkward one for Davis. He slips over back to Zach Foot. Can't find his foot. Melksham wrapped up by Bokey.
It's going to be just very hard to get the ball out of the Casey forward line here for Southport. Be locked in here for a few minutes.
Such a well-drilled team, Casey. They do the fundamentals so well. Munro tackled by Willis. Ball underneath that pair.
They don't cough the ball up. They don't need to do anything outrageous here. They can just have stoppage after stoppage. Keep the pressure up.
Woodcock and Charlesworth smothered by Munro. Bokey gets absolutely poleaxed and he's down. Foot. Awkward half volley for Lockhart. Sliding in was Peskett. Takes out the legs of his own man, Heron. On the bottom of that pack is Buntine. He can't control it. Gets to his feet. Will go no further. Here's another look as Lockhart, Heron and Peskett all hit the deck.
Valentine and Charlesworth, the backup ruck options. Somehow Munro a kick. Willis through all and sundry at the contest. Peskett was clean. Off to Woodcock. A chance now for overlap and territory for the Sharks. The entry's shallow and it rushed on to Allison, who's got Gowers hot on his hammer with a fistful of jumper as well. Allison goes in again. Clever Gowers to keep it alive, but it favours quickly. Tomlinson could sense the danger with that kick. Shaded by Fields it was. But a chance for the Sharks to have the game in their part of the ground, and Jay Lockhart hobbling to the bench in front of us. He's got the blue paint from the Smithies VFL Grand Final logo all over him. He has been in the wars, the former Casey Demon. Valentine, Woodcock worn closely by Munro, who shaded him. Howes to Dunstan, got a kick clear, and it favoured Crosley, who's going to stay in motion, and rightly so, but the kick was cued. Maniz Wakefield turns it over at half-back, and Casey will try and slingshot.
He's got a man working out wide. It's Chandler. Possession 22 for Cade.
Must tighten up on Cade Chandler. He's absolutely destroying them.
Dunstan runs hard to half-forward to create an option. He goes further afield to Melksham, and that's a really good defensive fist in there from Reece Clark.
How some of Kate Chandler's kicks, Brownie? They've been literally 1 metre inside the boundary line, spot on to where the leading player has been going.
Yeah, and they haven't been too high to allow the defender in. He's just been placing it out in front of the leading forwards. He's been exceptional, and I know that the coaches' boxes are backing in their system at the moment, but they must show him a little bit more respect.
Choice on the bottom of that pack going nowhere. So Southport's game plan was based around trying to get it from the inside, first possession off the ruck, get it to the outside, spread and run. And obviously in these conditions, that's near impossible to do. So they're going to have to try and adapt, find another way to win this grand final. Ryan Davis to space. They just need to open the game up. Casey will take stoppage after stoppage. On the bounce to Peskett, but they're also going to need to be clean. Hard to play cute footy in these conditions. Good follow-up, Peskett. Off to Fields. Sizzles a kick towards half forward. On the bounce towards Charlesworth. King wrapped up, taken down by Munro.
And as we head down to Michael Barlow, Mickey, what can they do here to try and change things up?
Yeah, they've just got to get some more numbers to the contest. Watching it live and watching it ground level, the number of Casey Demons jumpers to Southport jumpers at contest, it's always plus one, plus two, and these are the conditions. So Southport need to show up more at contest, equalise that, and just stem this momentum, and then they might go on a run themselves.
Dunstan's to McVee, to White, handball shaded by Garn. That's a big turnover here because Casey were ahead of the footy, but they're still alive. Laurie got it back to White, who went off the ground. Valentine lost his footing, got a close down tape, and does. Mickey, what about the two players we saw in that piece of play? Tom Fields behind the ball, arguably their best and most penetrating kick, and the excitement, the movement, the speed of Max Peskin. Do they need to get him up the ground?
Yeah, Peskin's actually playing higher up the ground. So first half, really deep to the goal square. So they've brought him up to try and get him involved. They have identified Ryan Davis as the one to go from forward to back to give him some maturity behind the ball. So he's doing that. And Tom Fields, it's a clear directive every week to the Southport Sharks. Get the ball in his hands.
Fields and Peskin with 9 touches apiece so far for the Sharks, who need to find something. They haven't scored in the third quarter. They have kept Casey just to 1-2, though. The game's still close enough. Play let go as Laurie tries to get a body on Garn and happy to slap it towards the line. And similarly from Bedford.
Naturally, your forward structure does fall away, though, because the ball's been up Casey's end for most of this quarter. All the forwards are trying to roll up. You're expecting just a really quick kick from stoppage here if Southport win it, so you do need some numbers up there, and they can't get that transition.
Valentine got the tap. It was a nice one to Bedford, who tries to step through some traffic. Southport player down.
Two.
Woodcock, Crosley down, and also Fife. Free kick over the shoulder going Southport's way. You can hear the Sharks fans trying to lift their team, and there it was. Bit of friendly fire there. And then down goes Crosley in a separate incident.
Both back to their feet now.
Dawson to Woodcock. Tied for second spot in the Liston Trophy, those two this year. Can they lift their team? Clark, as they try to find some expanse. Fields' kick was smothered off his boot. Well played, Casey. And that's all they need to do right now is just blanket Southport. They don't have to do anything themselves. They just need to sit on the Sharks.
Braden Crosley coming off in the hands of the trainer at the moment. He's got some blood coming from his nose, so Mickey will be all over that. But their big ruckman, their presence around these stoppages coming off for a spell due to the blood rule.
You just feel like we're going to enjoy watching him play out his VFL career, and then the WWE awaits for Braden Crosley.
He's a carer during the week.
That was a wonderful story. Credit to the 7 years Gold Coast team, the story they did on both he and Boyd Woodcock and their little mate Jacko during the course of the week. Jump on social media and check it out. And as Jace, as you highlighted in your tweet, players in this league and also the AFL, so fantastic with what they do in the community is Davis and Melksham. The 30-year-olds will be beaten to the line.
Big shout-out to Jacko Kirkham, massive Southport Sharks fan, 11-year-old, up on the Gold Coast. Boyd, Braden do physio with him in the morning. They help him get ready for school. They then take him to school. Work as carers during the day and then head off to footy training. And there's quite a few of the Sharks players that do that in the community.
Valentine in the ruck. Joyce was wearing one from Bedford as Miniz Wakefield had nowhere to get out of the phone booth. Comes free to Woden. He was being held. Super commitment from Garn to the outside man Teat. Low down Dunstan was clean. Pops the handball with good technique. Bedford tried to somehow get it to himself in a dry weather play. So margin at 14, 23 now, 24 minutes into the third. Jimmy Munro's goal at the 6-minute mark. The only major of the premiership quarter.
Charlesworth to go against Wiedemann. Wiedemann uses the body strongly. Umpire says play on. Munro goes hunting it at the back. Manteet takes him down with Joyce. Socket towards the pocket. And this suits Casey just fine.
Yeah, well, their mentality is being good wet weather footy. They're just slapping it forward, soccering it forward. They don't really care how it gets forward, but just he's doing the concussion test. Great man. That's what you do when you get pulled over for drink driving.
I'll take your word for it.
Well, I assume back in the olden days, the policeman would ask you to do that, stand on one leg. Brilliant.
Manteet taken down by Melksham. Ferocious tackle. Davis threw a boot at it. Out of bounds on the full, and they just cannot escape the Casey clutches. As we mentioned, they're so well drilled, Casey.
so good at just shutting teams down when they're not in control of the game, and then when they are, they do this. Just lock on and grind you into the mud. Kick inside 50 again. Well done, Seb Tate. Spun through a bit of traffic, off to Manteek. Southport keep battling. Townsend will be beaten to it by Smith, who can wind up from inside the centre square. Pins the ears back, got great penetration on that kick, but missed left.
It was a dangerous kick coming out of the back half, right into the middle of the ground, and I like that from Smith. No need to finesse in these conditions.
So with the three behinds in this quarter, Casey have got it out to a three-score game. Can almost breach the three-goal mark. The one thing with the margin in Southport's favour, as we know, if it becomes a centre clearance game, 6-6-6, you can clear it and score repeatedly in a hurry, hard in the conditions as it may be. Bokey, clean contact, and suddenly things open up. Gowers. So it's Townsend. Buntine is the option inside 50. That's the one-on-one. Foot's going to try and run it forward. They'll link by hand. Gowers paddling. Space now. Lockhart back onto the ground against his former side. Well done, Tajwo Woden. Rang the length of the ground to be the goalkeeper.
It was the most dangerous passage of play we've seen from them for the quarter. A little bit of luck involved with just a hack kick out of the air from Bokey, landed on a chest.
No, Woden goes for distance. Feels like Southport are just one goal away from being back in the contest. But similarly, if it goes the other way, it's a long way back. Melksham slips the tackler. Brown, he was tackled right as the ball arrived. Munro sweeps onto it. Has got White forward of the football. Hoisted high. Standing underneath it, Jake Melksham.
Great composure from Jimmy Munro as well.
Bedford all alone in the corridor by himself. Heads in that direction. He'll fly over the top. It'll get to the front. Here's a chance for Davis to Dawson. Has to be tidy. And it's juggled just inside the line by Willis. 27 minutes gone, third term. Can Southport find a goal that can change this grand final? Lockhart. Things opening up for them in the last couple of minutes towards Gowers. Just looms are so important. Gowers as the link man. That's a good strong tackle from Pescud. We know Billy Gowers has got some X-factor, Brownie. He's just got to find a way to impact the game.
Yeah, he can do the unpredictable, can't he? And they need something, a long goal that can skid through from 60 or a big, strong one-on-one mark.
At the moment, on the fall from the stoppage, it was off the boot of Luke Dunstan.
At the moment, you feel that the Casey defenders are under so much pressure in the first quarter. They've just found their rhythm. They found their flow, their matchups, and they are impenetrable.
Well, they've had a breather. They've got to switch on here because they've given away the free and the advantage. King takes it. Pescud through the fingertips. Still a dangerous time. Townsend already got one. Free kick. Oh big call. Big Joel kick. Smith infringes and Jacob Townsend, two goals in the 2019 decider here. Here's the replay.
And not a lot in that, but the umpire was on the right side. And both these clubs are only going to get a handful of opportunities in front of goals. Very, very easy shots. Pescud dropped the mark. There went one opportunity. Townsend might have got the lucky free kick, but this is a massive kick.
2017 JJ Liston Trophy winner, who kicked their first goal of the game at the six-minute mark. They have not kicked a major since 23 minutes into the first. They stay alive in the grand final.
They gave themselves an opportunity on the INC Sports Nutrition replay of getting a shot on goal because they got an inside 50 and they looked a little bit dangerous. Lockhart had a shot only moments earlier. On this occasion, it was Townsend. So they've just got to find a way to get those inside 50s up and give their forwards opportunity one-on-one.
Clutch goal. That was the one they needed. Michael Barlow. Is Braden Crosley about to check back into the action?
He's about to check back into the action. The Mo's ready to go. Just a little bit of work on the beak, just across the bridge of the nose, past concussion protocol, and he'll be inserting himself back in the narrative very quickly.
Critical last stages of this third term. Can the Ds respond or can Southport surge again? Woodcock towards half forward. Lockhart, the entire pack collapsed on him. Well done, McVee at the back. He was tidy to Turner, who goes high and wide. Garn stands underneath it. Brown arrived late, got it to the deck. White socket it forward. Garn's got a couple to beat. The numbers should win out here for the Ds, and they do. Howes received the tap on from Brown. Kicks towards half forward. Spencer the spoil. Dunstan the crumb. Delivers inside 50. Laurie!
How clean was that from Luke Dunstan? below his knees, and then the beautiful little chip kick over the top. Laurie just needed to find the body at the exact right time here, just nudged him under the footy.
Missed the preliminary final with that right shoulder. You can see it strapped up. Talented young man, 20 years of age, from Beverly Hills and Caulfield Grammar. 20 VFL games, his second year on the Melbourne list. This for the quick response. Oh, that's big. Brownie, they say the thing that kills you is the hope. And Casey just slammed the door back on Southport's fingers then.
It's big psychologically, isn't it? Because for 28 minutes, Southport toiled to try and get their first goal of the quarter, and it is immediately responded back in the INC Sports Nutrition Replay.
23 majors for the year for Laurie, who played in a NAB League premiership for the Oakley Chargers on this ground 3 years ago. Dunstan having a huge third quarter. He's up to 21. Chandler, White, 22 apiece. For Casey Woodcock, at game high 24 for the Sharks. Gray spun, good tackle that came free, but again Dunstan finding a way to be quick hand to foot. Laurie overran it. Opportunity for Willis. Bokey stepping Chandler, finding his left. White back with a flight super mark from the Casey skipper.
Dawson only 13 disposals for the day. His direct opponent doing a wonderful run with roll.
The Norm Goss is going to be interesting. There's some contenders.
White's ball's going to flirt with the line and get out.
Dunstan with 22. White's now got 23. Chandler's been great. Jimmy Munro, 19. 15 tackles and a goal.
Such a hard game to judge for the lack of clean possession as well.
15 tackles and we've got a quarter to go. Wowee.
Willis. Fist from Townsend and Crosley camped at the base of it. What a slog it's been. A super grand final. Mitch White, a little bit of a corky perhaps, heading for the bench. And Jacob Townsend, another tough hombre, shaking off the effects.
33 minutes gone. Margin back out to 15 points. Can Southport manufacture something? No, they cannot. And at three-quarter time, the Casey Demons in control. Still plenty of time for Southport to come at them late. But as we turn for home in the grand final, it's the D's by 15 points. They're 6-8-44. Southport, 4-5-29.
Seven's coverage of the VFL is brought to you by Thirsty Camel Bottle Shops. Join Hump Club and start saving today.
Three-quarter time in the 2022 Seven VFL Grand Final. Jimmy Munro, the Moose, kicking a goal in that third term. It's Casey kicking 2-3-1 straight goal in that third quarter. They led by 6 points at halftime, the D's. Townsend responded, and then Bailey Laurie slammed the door once again to get it back to 15 points. Casey 6-8-44, Southport 4-5-29. Mitch White 23 touches, 11 tackles. Luke Dunstan 22 possessions, 8 of those contested with 7 tackles. Kate Chandler's had 22 possessions, 11 contested, 5 tackles. And Jimmy Munro outstanding as well. As we take a look at the overall numbers, Brownie, and as we mentioned from the second term onwards, Casey able to get the game on their terms. Southport, to their credit, looked really good the last 5 or 6 minutes.
Yeah, they certainly did. I think the messaging would be for the Southport Sharks is you've got to get the game going forward. Slap it forward, kick it forward, hack it forward. Get our forwards one-on-one, moving towards the ball, not trying to get it out the back, and just create some opportunities.
So Casey led in the 2016 Grand Final and lost. They led in the 2018 Grand Final and lost. They have one quarter to go. Let's take you into their huddle. Here's Mark Corrigan.
To defend, to do the things, and help us win this game. George, it's off the back of our defence.
Thank you.
We play the game in our front half exactly the way we want to. The one little area is taking away those quick little outlets, yep. Okay? So if you're in the assess layer, you can still get up on them. You don't have to give them 4 or 5 metres. Be tight, because any little quick dump we've got covered. It's giving them that time and space to turn and then send it. It's then giving them an opportunity. Yep. Come in.
Come on. Come on, boys.
Michael Barlow was in the Southport huddle. Mickey, what did you hear?
It's really animated about no sag off those forwards. So Kate Chandler is the one that's coming up really high. So no sag. Try and equalise the numbers. So from all reports, I think Southport will try and equalise around the ground, turn into a one-on-one battle. and try and win it from there.
Has the rain disappeared just momentarily at least?
It's gone. My left arm is very wet from the surge in the third quarter, but all clear at the moment.
You're always good in the heavy conditions, Mickey.
Thanks, wasn't he?
Thanks, guys.
Casey, just they don't need to change anything. If they can bring manic pressure again for 30 more minutes of this season, they'll be premiers.
Final quarter of the VFL season, thanks to Thirsty Camel Bottle Shops. We thank them and all our sponsors this year for 7 VFL. I think Toby might still need his jumper. We've got a quarter to play. And it is Casey by 15 points. Can Southport come at them? We're about to find out. Wiedemann against Crosley. It's got to start in the middle for the Sharks. Crosley tries to muscle his way through. Can Joyce get involved? It's socket back the other way for Casey towards half forward. Melksham's taken down by his man, Tate. Gunn wrapped up by Bedford and Laurie.
They just haven't allowed Southport time and space since quarter time.
Crosley, nice tap, and they get a clearance through Heron. That's what they need, those clean takeaways to get the ball moving. Inside 50, can Townsend and Gowers get them back in the game? Lockhart stripped of it by Turner. Gowers puts a tackle on. King tries to escape McPhee and Munro and cannot.
Something fell away there structurally to allow Southport straight through the front of that stoppage. There was no quarterback there that he would have run straight into.
Joyce right from the 50. Buntine back with the flight, flicks it through the fingers and knew it was going between the behinds and the points. So there's another storm cell currently tracking its way to the northwest and west of the city. And Icon Park might be in the firing line for the third quarter in a row in the middle part of the quarter, which is another thing for the Sharks to bear in mind as the lights have taken full effect, even though we are barely past 3 p.m. in the afternoon here. Brown, a sensational mark. He's got Van Ruin lengthening for him. He's got goal side of his opponents. And Rhys Clark sprinted 40 metres to get parallel with him. And that'll create the one-on-one here that you see. Van Ruin almost on the third bite. Boakey so good in the first half for the Sharks. Dunstan, he's been clean. Kick ricocheted to Brown. He'll push it forward. Melksham's got goal side and protected the drop zone on Willis. He's got a vacant channel to goal if he wants to try and kick and skid it through. The veteran who kicked the first goal of the match.
It's great work rate by Mitch Brown because he was the man that kicked it long down the line. He's the man that got the ricochet from the smother and looked up, saw the space. Jake Melksham protected the ball drop beautifully.
A magnificent second half of his AFL season as a forward. 12 goals from his 11 games, 4 against the Blues in round 22. The 31-year-old hunting a premiership medal. It's going to get all the way. Has Crosley got a hand on it? He hasn't.
Eight weeks since he's put on a Casey jumper, been playing AFL in the back half of the year, the Thirsty Camel replay. You can see just good body positioning there to protect the drop of the ball, to take the mark, and then he absolutely flushed that outside 50. Every single player came to him here to celebrate. They know that they are just about home.
Margin sits now at 20. Southport needs some clean takeaways. Can Crosley help provide them? He'll go again against Wiedemann, who's battled hard in the ruck this afternoon. That'll be a recall.
Love to see Crosley just slapping it forward, holding Wiedemann off with his strength and just getting the ball going forward. That's not going to work.
Free kick. We're running under the football. Wiedemann to Dunstan.
They don't need to move the ball quickly now, Casey.
Van Ruin. Well, Davis came over the top intending to spoil and ended up marking it.
Unexpectedly there.
It's Southport that now need to take the chances and be bold. Try to open the ground up, get the ball moving. Southport wanted in motion. Casey happy to have stoppage after stoppage and shut the game down as they've done pretty successfully. Right through the third term, bar the last couple of minutes, as Spencer down the line. Could use the body from Lockhart. Smith gets it to Buntine, who paddles it in the Baker direction. He can't keep it alive. And it'll be a Southport ball. And it'll go to Max Spencer. It's
Well, 17 and 18 on the Gold Coast list, did Max, after being referred by Mickey Barlow. Kick to half forward. Spills to Woodcock. Slight fumble. It's got some support. Heron gets it to Joyce. High kick. Crosley stands underneath it. Past McVee. Here's a chance for Johnson. Only man back is Woe Woden.
I watched him track that from the middle of the ground, and he positioned himself absolutely perfectly there as the winger.
Oodles of space for Brown to find Tomlinson, and they've got overlap near here as Tomlinson to Bedford. He can keep it moving for Dunstan if he wants. He's off his line, forced to kick on the 45, back to Woe Woden.
Just that offside work rate from Woe Woden to get back into deep 50.
It's the spatial awareness that makes you think he can be an AFL winger without too many problems. Dawson with his shadow white, coughs it up Van Ruin. A bevy of options. In the end, he decides to kick, tumble it. Bedford will turn tackler on Davis, pancaked him in the back.
He just fell forward, didn't they? And Davis needs to just take the game on here. He's got players on the far side. The switch is on.
Send it in that direction. Bun time with work to do on Crosley. Did well. Joyce continues to find the right spots. Handball over the top for Heron. He'll step inboard. Laurie will try and close the space down. Good use from Heron. This is better from the Sharks. Charlesworth slipped when he didn't need to, but they just have to stay in motion here. He checks his kick. It's touched. There'll be play on for Smith. Casey from the back.
Garn stands underneath this one. Bedford gets it to ground. It's taken by Melksham. He can use Baker. He's happy to hold it up as Bedford tracks to 50.
Because of the wet conditions, Southport players haven't been pulling back off the mark, which has been bringing the man on the mark into play. We saw it on that occasion, just a smothered ball, which should never usually happen.
Crosley holds Dunstan up, and now Dunstan goes. Delivers to the pocket. Bokey's been outstanding.
Particularly with the stand rule, Brownie, the way it is now, if you're the kicker, you should virtually never get it anywhere near the man on the mark.
They're just really desperate to play on quickly, but you've still got to take a few metres back to allow yourself some room.
It's cost them a couple of times.
Crosley in the middle of the ground in the third quarter as well.
D's by 20. Circling, looking for the knockout blow. Get over the back for Bedford. He uses Munro. Tackle came from Garn as the rain starts to fall again. Brown brought it down, but it wouldn't be the required distance even if it hadn't have hit the deck. Ball up, 40 out from the Casey goal. Was that some lightning? Crosley. There's the thunder. Dawson. Might be another dimension to our 2022 VFL Grand Final. There's the thunder you can hear it in the background. You mentioned the storm cell.
Hopefully it can stay away for the next 20 minutes.
So the AFL rules around lightning pretty strict. I'll be checking the radar as we speak. Munro wrapped up by Crosley, taken to ground.
So if you're just joining us, Casey kicked the first goal through Jake Melksham 4 minutes in. Southport with 3 goals in a 17-minute burst. They led by 12. Taj Woe Woden with a goal close to quarter time. The Sharks by 7 at quarter time. Casey have kicked 2-3 in both the second and third quarters. They had a 6-point advantage at the half. That grew to 15 at three-quarter time. And Jake Melksham second puts the margin at its current 20-point gap. As the Sharks will get a free. Matt Garn against his former side with the free kick, as the rain, not surprisingly, kicks in for the third instalment of the middle part of the quarter. Lockhart is a hold, in fact, and it's going to go the way of the Demons. Lockhart's dropped to four.
It's going to be 50.
He thought it was a monumental call, and really, Jake Lockhart, you've got to give him the benefit of the doubt there.
Well, he thought it was going to his teammate, and that's why he's dropped it at the feet of the Southport Shark player there, rather than going directly to Casey. And he knows, you can see, well, he thought he'd taken the mark to start with, and he thinks...
He didn't see the hole.
No. Nah. So...
It wasn't his contest.
But that extra second, just to clarify it with the umpire, might have helped. Oscar Baker now in range.
So Oscar Baker, after playing his 50th AFL game in the preliminary final, the Cup's going to need an E-tag.
He's missed.
He's missed. No.
Oh, he's wow. in there. No one knows. The quick play here and from Southport.
Southport are on the charge.
Oh, this is amazing.
They kick it to the middle of the ground. Now the D's scramble back. They thought it was through it. Miss right.
Oh, they were in a huddle at centre-half forward, cheering and celebrating.
It was like the old-fashioned huddle from the kick-in, and it actually worked okay for the D's.
Yeah, they've ended up with the ball back, and Oscar Baker still can't believe it.
It was chaos for a moment.
Just imagine if Southport went coast to coast there.
Big fly over the top, Van Ruin. Brown goes down. Bokey kicks it into Van Ruin. D's have got numbers behind the ball. Wiedemann and Johnson, big collision. Umpire pays a free kick. So here's another look.
So
umpire comes across. Yeah, he can clearly see he's missed it.
But clearly it fooled all the Casey players on the field.
So Wiedemann to the top of the square. Melksham won't quite get there. Brown did. Manteat off to Woodcock. Will just go for territory. Can they get it over the back? They can. Lockhart, can he step through some traffic? What's he got forward of the football? Has to put it out into the path of Gowers. That is a magnificent kick. Gowers couldn't hang on. Allison does really well. Had a couple to beat. Did enough. Allowed the cavalry to arrive. Quickly. Laser Shepherd.
The one thing that stands out in these wet, slippery conditions are players that are clean below their knees. And we've seen Luke Dunstan on multiple occasions. One touch, which just sets up passages of play. On that occasion, they are out. Billy Gowers couldn't quite pick it up. He just transferred the pressure on to his fellow teammate, and they get a stoppage instead of a certain inside 50.
So the wind has certainly picked up. It's blowing Southport's way. You can see it. They're kicking with the tide now in this final term. It's hammering in at a 45-degree angle. Margin sits at 21 as we approach the 12-minute mark of the last term. Crosley, Manteat, socket off the ground. They just need to keep it moving forward. Another drop from Gowers. Woodcock goes hard against Gray. Umpire says you dragged it in. Free kick going to the D's, who are just so good at doing the basics.
Credit to both teams to endure these conditions in the season decider. Wiedemann in from the side, decided to go the mark on the chest. Off the ground went Manteat. It'll work for Woodcock, closing him down. Bedford, who decided to bump to impact the kick. Tomlinson in from the side. It beats to the back, and Turner wants the line. He'll get it.
He's tried really hard, Woodcock, this afternoon. 29 touches.
So margin at 20. Adam Tomlinson, who played in the GWS Giants AFL Grand Final 3 years ago, on the verge of winning a VFL title. Van Ruin is his intended target, but it slipped wide for Manteat. Maniz Wakefield stayed out of the protected zone. Quickly back with the flight. Big fist from Smith. And then one from Gray as well. Maniz Wakefield left it for Melksham. He kicks deep. Clark had eyes on the footy and takes a supermark in the conditions. Drives it on the left. Wide for Lockhart. Almost. Just couldn't take it. Tomlinson shovels for Woden and it nutmegs him. Joyce has got the body for the conditions. Smith's got him and they'll crock roll to the line.
It's a couple of half chances. Billy Gowers drop mark. 30 out only moments ago. And that occasion, Lockhart going back with the flight. Very markable, but these wet conditions made it hard.
Crosley went looking for a rover that wasn't there.
I can see a pocket of blue sky to our west from our commentary position, Jace.
That's a little consolation to anyone in the elements right now. Mickey Barlow, you'd be delighted to hear there's a pocket of blue way off to the west.
I just had to let go of one of my two umbrellas to talk to you guys. Yeah. This is, you know, when you watch the movies and they put the rain and it's just really heavy, heavy rain and it's effects rain. That's what it's like down here at the moment. So Southport will need a miracle. But they're just starting to go and take the game on, and that's their only chance, really.
Woodcock to Heron. He throws a boot at it. Can they get a bounce? It gets to Gowers at the top of the square. Still there. Johnson, back heel from Pescott, went in the wrong direction. Townsend slides in. Pescott puts the pressure on. Allison looks sore. He caught one in the head in the mass of bodies flying around in all directions.
They've just got to find an avenue to goal here from this stoppage. Time is their greatest enemy now.
Crosley. Wiedemann. Oh, Wiedemann kicked it into George Gray.
which hurt both of them. Wiedemann's sore and Gray is too, as you can imagine in these conditions. His cold, actual, wet, slippery.
Wiedemann's actual tap work as a ruckman has been terrific this afternoon.
Certainly been a role he's been thrown into late in the season, and he showed an extra string to his bow, another dimension to his game. Crosley to the top of the square. Munro will happily just flip it through under sufficient pressure to get away with that. And the margin moves to 19 points. We've played 15 minutes.
And the lightning call was the right one. Jace Brownie having some news coming through that the race meeting going on close to here at Flemington this afternoon delayed in the last hour or so as a result of lightning in the area. So thankfully it hasn't impacted the VFL Grand Final. Geez, Chandler's impacted it though. Waited for the space, got it to Baker, might get it back. The handball though missed Willis. Bokey hung on to by Baker, and again Casey force it to the line. Kate Chandler, what an afternoon, what an influence he's had. 23 possessions, 11 of them contested, 5 tackles, 4 inside 50s.
And going at 92% by foot today, Nudge, where everyone else has been turning the ball over in slippery conditions.
And 8 marks in these conditions indicates the work rate that he's done to find himself in the space. Speaking of work rate, Sam Wiedemann conceding centimetres and kilos to Braden Crosley has more than matched his bigger opponent in the ruck this afternoon. Van Ruin will get a jump at it, decided to go chest. White, it slews off the side of his boot. The clever Bedford, calculating things, decided to go himself. It'll work its way back for a point.
They're the best options in these conditions, rather than trying to conjure up something of the impossible on a dry day. Just get it forward, get another score.
Retreat, teat straight up the middle to Peskett, who almost completed the mark. Jimmy Munro lays another tackle. Tackle number 17 for Jimmy. Bokey stood up all day, slaps that one out. Still pinging around, sliding in there with Seb Tate. Gray just goes off the ground, moves it forward. Here's a chance. Melksham, brilliant! KC will win their first premiership of the century.
Jake Melksham with his third Thirsty Camel replay. Class rises to the top in big games in wet, slippery conditions, and he's kicked 2 really big last quarter goals. But Jimmy Munro, well, 17 tackles. He's had more tackles than 37 players this afternoon have had disposals, Jason. Unprecedented.
That is an impressive stat, Campbell.
Melksham 3, 2 of them in the last. Margin at 26. Putting himself perhaps late in Norm Goss medal contention. Chandler's got to be in it as well. Maniz Wakefield looking to get involved. Brown's got the drop on Clark and almost the mark. And it's hit the behind post, so we'll have the ball thrown in. Reece Clark, he has battled manfully for Southport in defence, leaving nothing in the tank this afternoon. One of those 5 players in the lineup this afternoon to play in their last premiership in the NEAFL in 2018. White, Bedford, Brown off the ground, through the legs. And now the cup needs an E-tag.
They've been the benchmark side of the competition right from round 1. 17-1 in the regular season. Won the qualifying final by 49 points. 47 points. The preliminary final by 51, and have been near flawless again this afternoon, Casey.
Out of the slot. And back into it. Munro gets a face full of mud. And he's never been happier. Like a moose in, well, you know what. Oh, big hit on Howes. Munro goes down. Crosley takes him to the deck. Dawson down as well. Heron. Quick kick McPhee. Bokey will get there first. Bedford puts the body on. Baker can't keep it alive.
It's no surprise that 2 of the better performers today, Mitch White and Jimmy Munro, have had that hurt, that disappointment sitting in their guts for a long time, the two grand final losses.
Crosley a little late on McPhee, and Dan Turner lets him know about it.
Something that doesn't leave you when you've lost a close grand final, especially if you thought you were good enough to win it.
And they've been there twice on the receiving end. Seb taped down. He's had a tough couple of weeks. Then gets up, wins the football, runs into traffic. Wiedemann's little handball to the line. Sam Wiedemann, another to have played in a losing grand final, stood up today in the ruck, had a huge job against Braden Crosley. Couldn't allow the big man to completely dominate on the inside, and he hasn't. He's acquitted himself well in this new role. Joyce, Chandler, White. Pressured out of it, Willis. Here's Munro. Can he get the arms free? He can, to White. Bokey tries to get away from Laurie. Pokes it down the line. Lockhart, Buntine in there. Munro clipped on the way through by Joyce.
Jimmy Munro caked in Icon Park mud as Baker and Foot go at it. 38 hitouts to 30 in the Crosley-Wiedemann battle. What a duel it's been. And maybe it'll get some AFL clubs thinking about what they do with Sam Wiedemann, perhaps for a second AFL life if he's not at Melbourne in 2023. Melksham, clean pickup, Bokey. One of Southport's best without doubt, and White happy to see to the line, who's done a super job on Jacob Dawson, both in the team of the year on Monday night. Mitch White, 28 possessions, a game high, while taking on the job of shutting down one of the league's best midfielders in Jacob Dawson, and shutting down he has. 15 touches for Dawson, and his clearance game down with just the three for the afternoon as well.
He's been averaging 30 touches a year, so he's at half of what he normally has.
So Casey, minutes away from their first title in 23 years. Three-time premiership captain Kane Taylor, who lifted the cup here 26 years ago in an incredible victory against Frankston, will present the trophy to winning captain Mitch White and Mark Corrigan. Steve Harrison, a five-time winner of the Gardner Clark Medal, to present the Norm Goss to the best player on the ground. Should it be a Casey player? As Maniz Wakefield, what a story he is out of Melbourne's NGA program in the Northern Territory, Nightcliffe in the NT Thunder. His mother, T. Marie's, he doesn't turn 19 until late October, and he's going to be a VFL Premiership player after playing 15 games for Casey this year. Baker and Manteat in the foot race, and they all leave it. Manteat back with the winning raffle ticket. Tumbling ball rushes on a Lockhart. Doing well just to be out there. Allison shut him down. Fields got a kick forward. Oh, Joel Smith having his way with Pescott, and a careful hand to slow things down.
So three goals in the first quarter and one since then for Southport. They've just been completely outplayed since quarter time.
Wiedemann off the hands of the pack, looking for Van Ruin. Fife got in the way. Kick from Tate towards half forward. There is Pescott. Lockhart ran over the top of it. Munro another possession, back to the wing. Couple to beat here for Van Ruin in the air. Well done, Bedford on the deck. Tried to tap it to Baker. Slap forward was really good from Davis. Here's Woodcock. 32nd touch from him. Delivers inside 50. Will get to the front of the contest. Can Pescott get there? He cannot. Joel Smith again. High kick. Woodcock almost. A spectacular grab.
He's tied his heart out.
Munro takes Crosley down. That's been a bit of a rolling battle today. And Braden wins this chapter, but Jimmy's going to win the war.
Not the man that you probably want late in a wet, cold day landing on you. That is 115 kilos.
Has he lost a couple? Goes over the back and minor out of bounds, rather. There's Billy Gowers. Steve had him at 117 last week.
He's been on a diet. A plain food.
Braden Crosley, what a warrior. Had a fantastic season. Thrown it out first ruck when they lost their first ruckman, Fraser Thurlow. Unsettled them for a few weeks. But Crosley's really risen to the occasion in the back half of the season. Jimmy Munro lays tackle number 18.
That's got to be some sort of record in the grand final.
Wiedemann, Crosley. Couple of taps, King.
Munro sockers off the ground. Chandler can't control it, neither can Peskett. Bedford in there as well. The spin from Garn, can't get away from Howes. Taken to the deck, umpire lets it play. Garn picks it up again, and again Howes takes him to the ground.
Mark Collingwood would be super proud of his group. Everything he's thrown at them this year, they've just adapted to. So well drilled, structured. Just their hunger for the contest.
White, where's one from Dawson to Dunstan, who's been the other man in the midfield to really give them composure and cleanliness around the contest. 20 of 26 possessions for Dunstan have been kicks.
Player down off the play here. That's Jimmy like Munro, is it? It is.
There's Timmy. And
a hard time getting him off the ground, particularly in these last few minutes. And,
and the doctors have said you've got to come off, and he's not happy. Off.
Just from a bump there when he wasn't suspecting it from Jacob Townsend. Might have been a little clash of the heads as well.
He's furious too, Jimmy. He wants to be out there when the siren comes, but if they can clear him, he might be a chance to come back regardless. Player safety first and foremost. Crosley deep, Gowers against. Now that's out on the full, potentially off Tomlinson's leg here. Free kick.
The thing about Casey Nudge all year, and we've seen him a lot, they don't do anything spectacular. They just are so well structured, and they just do the absolute best time and time and time again. So many experienced players.
Nice moment there between Mark Corrigan and Jimmy Munro. Going to realise their premiership dream as player and coach.
Heron Fields, nice smother. Oh, again from Turner. He wears two and gets up and says, is that all you got?
That is absolutely brilliant.
And in they come. Southport players, the tinderbox is lit.
No, they should have done this at half-time. Southport, they've left it too late. That is brilliant from Turner.
Ball thrown back into play. That'll break up the fight. Chance here for Southport at the back. Flying shot, a goal is through. Southport get one back.
They're still wrestling in the pocket.
Reece King with the goal.
Turner with just 27-minute mark of the last quarter of a grand final, diving at the boot of the player, not once but twice. Not sure what sparked the melee.
They came from everywhere. It was on. The frustration bubbling over for Southport. The jubilation of Casey knowing they've got it. What an effort here from Dan Turner. First and then again.
Too little, too late.
And it was the lip.
Oh, there's nothing wrong with that. That was a spectacular grand final effort. And
the Southport players seem to disagree with you.
Yeah, and they finally get a goal. Good umpiring too, just to throw the ball back in. That is the best way to disperse things. But a goal too little, too late. And
so margin back to 26 points. It's been a long journey for the KCDs. With some disappointments along the way this century. They've had some fine teams, but just haven't been able to get it done in September. Dawson sockers it forward. Wrapped up. And this means a lot, Nudge, to Casey Demon fans and Springvale Scorpion fans everywhere.
Yeah, I think it's a lot for people both on and off the field who've been pivotal into the move. And it was a bold one to go away from your heartland of Springvale in 2005, as we see a crunching tackle applied. And there's skirmishes as now it's Melksham and Jacob Townsend who are nose to nose. So the Sharks flying the flag late that it's going to be to no avail. Emergency umpire Harry Birch coming onto the ground. But Jace, people like President John Sharkey, a former player, and Brian Woodman, who was the general manager at the time. David Dillon, who took over as president from John Sharkey. Mike Tyler, who was the CEO of Casey Fields at the time of, sorry, the city of Casey. And they had the vision for the precinct, which is so pivotal now to not just Casey, but I think our game as a whole. It's an AFLW venue, as we know, and doing a wonderful job for so many people playing sport in the southeast. Dawson deep. It's to the advantage as well of Davis, who cannons into Turner. Bedford lost the footing. Paddling it was Heron. Winning the day cleverly was Howes, and he'll trickle it wide, and Woden was waiting for it. And it'll be thrown in. Greg Pendlebury, who got life membership of the VFL on Monday night after 40 years of service to both Oakley, Springvale and Casey. What a remarkable rise he's had through the game, from a member of the cheer squad at Oakley in the early 80s to a trainer and then a board member and football manager at Casey, and then players like Evan Pinoza, Kyle Matthews, James Wall, who were the people to help establish the footy club in its formative years at Casey Fields. Van Ruin inboard. Time for one more, perhaps. Woden. Melksham, perhaps, for four. Party time.
Jakey Melksham with three last quarter goals for Casey. He hadn't played through the Casey final series until today. Eligible to come back into this side.
Yeah, his ninth game this afternoon. Played a lot of those early in the year, as you mentioned.
And Tom McDonald was out. We thought structurally that might hurt a little bit, but probably the smaller player in Melksham might have really suited these conditions a bit more. And he's just, he knows where space is. He reacts quickly and he's so damaging.
Well, the 21st century had been pretty disappointing for Demons fans, both at VFL and AFL level, and now in the space of 12 months, they collect a cup in each competition.
Great development too for the young Melbourne players. That's what builds really important, successful systems.
Another example of that correlation between the two programs. We've seen it for the last decade and more, just how important it is. Baker. Back inside 50. Free kick for a hold as Bedford was heading goalward. So four goals to Jake Melksham, two to Mitch Brown. Two experienced forwards just stood up at key moments today. Six between them on a day like today is a large return. Bedford's still on his own. I think Buntine's saying, I'm going to go back.
He turned his back there.
It's party time. I'm going to launch one.
He'd need a barrel.
Well, he kicked four goals in 67 AFL games. He's kicked two goals in the VFL in his 23 games. So six goals in 90 games. If you're ever going to take a barrel, it's at the 33-minute mark of a grand final. In the end, he just wanted to milk the time. Let us all down. Inside 50. Van Ruin, was he taken high? Picked up by Heron. Now Dawson and out to Boakey, who's been one of Southport's best.
You'd love to see both he and Pescud get their AFL opportunity at some stage in the future. Dunstan, Buntine, Joel Smith, free kick, and the skirmishes continue.
I thought Boakey was one of the best players on the ground up until half-time.
And on cue, the rain clears at Icon Park and the celebrations can begin with blue skies overhead.
I thought your cyclone-proof hair was going to get tested at one point.
Mark to Ryan Davis, who bid farewell to State League footy. Baker versus Manteat. Van Ruin. No goals, but certainly impacts. Melksham with four. What a game he's had. Van Ruin. Melksham again. Slaps it out. Baker held his width. They played it tough. They played to win. They are the premier side. For the first time in 23 years, they'll bring the flag back home. Casey, VFL premiers.
It's the emblem for me and for you. It's the emblem of the team we love, the team of the red and the blue. Every heart beats true for the red and the blue, and we sing this song to you.
Excitement, relief, Brownie, all these things to suddenly come flooding to you. For some of these guys, they've played almost an entire football career. They're at the back end of it. A guy like Mitch White, who's been around for such a long time, 26 years of age, started out in 2015. And he's been on this journey, first with Melbourne, and then he decided he wanted to stick around and help. After he was off the AFL list, he stayed on the VFL list. That speaks volumes of his character as we head down to Mickey Barlow.
Yeah, got Jake Melksham, the last quarter hero, mate. The game man, the hero, who stood up, Jakey Melksham. The last eight games at AFL level, and to come back, obviously a bit bittersweet, but what a result.
Yeah, it was certainly a different week, training at night and out in the cold at Casey, which we usually do during the day, but it's much colder at night. But I played the first, you know, two-thirds of the year with these boys, and we really were building all year. Lots of senior players, lots of great young talent, and to come back after a disappointing week last week and have an opportunity to play in a grand final and win one, I was never going to let that opportunity slip, so it's great to be here.
And it clearly means a lot to the whole group, but that connection between AFL-listed and VFL-listed players, palpable at this club.
Yeah, it is. Casey's got a strong tradition right the way back when they were Springvale. The last two or three grand finals we've lost, so we've had strong seasons in the past, but to be able to capitalise on a great year and have that real one-club mentality right through from the senior list to the VFL list is great.
And to go from drowning the sorrows, you missed out on drowning the sorrows, now you need to celebrate with the premiership, so a missed week, but this week will be a big one.
It was a long week not drinking and thinking about a loss. So I'll enjoy a few beers tonight and, just enjoy a great success from the club.
Well done, mate. Good work.
Thanks, mate.
Well done to Jake Melksham. Brownie, it reminds me a little bit of Richmond when they won in 2019. Had a couple of years of getting close but not quite there, and eventually they got to the top.
Yeah, and once you get over that hurdle, you can see the current Melbourne players down there that weren't there. Maxie Gorn, the first into the huddle. It just means a hell of a lot because as a player, you know how hard they are to win.
Here's Mick with their coach. Congratulations, Mark Corrigan.
Yeah, the mastermind behind it all. 10 years ago as a player and now as a coach. Which one's more special?
I think as a coach because I felt like I had less control throughout the week. Or as a player, you know what you need to do to prepare and what that looks like, but trying to prepare a whole group, that's very different. So, really proud of the boys.
Yeah, and the challenge, I just spoke to Jake about that connection between AFL and VFL-listed clubs. Sitting boundary side today, it's palpable, that connection.
Yeah, I'm really lucky. I've got great leaders in the VFL program, but extraordinary leaders within our AFL. And so they're super at parking the disappointment if they're not playing AFL and coming back and buying in, and their engagement has been outstanding. So.
And talk to us about Jimmy Munro. Fascinates a lot of us, but he nearly got ripped off the ground to not spend time on the ground as the siren went, but he quickly got back out there. He seems like a special person, along with Mitch White.
Yeah, they are, mate. They're stalwarts of this club, and today for them is why they play football. And Jimmy Munro, he's the spirit of the club. He just doesn't waver. Like, they're so consistent week to week. They're amazing people. They're comfortable to be themselves, and they help everyone else be themselves. And from a group point of view, mate, they're just typical leaders, but they lead on field and off field.
From a player in 2012 to a coach in 2022, well done, Mark Corrigan.
Congratulations to Mark Corrigan. Well, Jimmy Munro, 21 possessions today, 10 ground ball gets, 12 contested, 17 tackles and a goal. His 10th season in the VFL, his 8th here with the Casey Demons, and he's finally made it to the top of the mountain. Here he is with Nudge.
This could be a hard one to get through, Jace. Jimmy, a journey to get here to say the least. 2 grand finals with heartbreak. Now finally a premiership player, and you deliver the first cup to Casey Fields. The feeling must be indescribable.
Oh, I'm lost for words, Nigel. I'm sorry. Like, I'm absolutely wrapped. It's certainly a dream come true for me. Over the moon.
The tour you've been through, not just at the level, but to get to the level. You're a hockey player. You went to Sandringham for a year, and then you decided to go to Casey Fields and try and climb the ladder of a club in a really strong alignment. You individually have been on such a journey to get to this point. That must be weighing on you right now.
Well, it's been the majority of my adult life playing for this footy club now, and there's no place like home, and that's what Casey Fields is to me, and I'm just absolutely rapt to be a premiership player. It's a dream come true.
What was the moment like when the siren went, and who were you with immediately?
I got to Bedford straight away. It was a bloke next to me, and then I looked around for my partner in crime, Whitey, and that's a moment I'll share with one of my best mates for the rest of my life.
And a lot more moments to come in the next couple of hours and the next couple of days. Jimmy Munro, premiership player, well done.
Thanks, Dodge. Sounds beautiful. Thanks, mate.
Paramedic by day, VFL premiership player by weekend. Congratulations to Jimmy Munro and the Casey Demons. Casey, 10-10-70. Commiserations to Southport, 5-8-38. The D's are the champs of 2022. To the victor, the spoils. It's time now for our post-match presentation. Casey, the champions of 2022. Here's our master of ceremonies, Nigel Carmody.
Hello, everyone. A fantastic return after 3 very long years for the Smithies VFL to Icon Park as it's hosted its 14th grand final in the competition. An incredible day of weather. Melbourne turning on 4 seasons, I think, given the contest we've just seen. A round of applause is required for both the Casey Demons and the Southport Sharks. Our umpires and officials are so pivotal to the Smithies VFL. I'd like to welcome forward boundary umpire Ty Duncan on behalf of today's umpires to receive medals. The Southport Sharks have been an incredible football club in their native Queensland. Today was their 24th grand final since 1983. Their first in the Smithies VFL. In just a season and a half, they've won 24 out of a possible 31 matches. An incredible job by coach Steve Daniel and the entire side to make their first VFL grand final. To say a few words on behalf of the Sharks, please welcome their co-captain, Michael Mantee.
Firstly, thank you so much to Smithies and the VFL. It's great to see community sport back. Casey, well done. Best team all year and congratulations to Southport. I'm so proud to be a part of this club. We have a fantastic club. Let's take home. We'll be back. We'll be better. And I'm looking forward to celebrating the year we had. So thanks very much to the fans. We're very, very grateful and everyone that travelled. Thank you.
What an Michael Mantee, Jacob Dawson, their co-captain, Coach Steve Daniel and Southport Sharks on a magnificent season. Since 1983, the Norm Goss medal has been handed out to the player who judged the best of field in the Smithies VFL Grand Final. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome forward a champion of both Springvale and Casey. He won a club record 5 Gardner Clark medals, their best and fairest in the 2000s. Steve Harrison to present the Norm Goss medal for 2022, and it goes to the Casey captain, number 52, Mitch White. Mitch will be back for the cup in a moment. Now I'd like to welcome forward members of the NAB AFL AusKick program to present medals to the 23 players in the winning Casey Demons side and also their coach in Mark Corrigan. We begin with number 12, Toby Bedford.
Toby Bedford, 11 VFL games this season, 13 goals.
Number 16, Bailey Laurie.
Bailey Laurie, second year on the Melbourne list. His 21st VFL game this afternoon, the young man from Beverly Hills and Caulfield Grammar, now premiership player.
Number 18, with 4 goals in the grand final, Jake Melksham.
208 AFL games. It's been a long journey for Jake Melksham, originally taken by Essendon back in 2009. Now he gets a medal around his neck.
Number 20, Adam Tomlinson.
From Canterbury and Trinity Grammar, taken by GWS in 2011. Had his share of injury issues, including an ACL. Missed out on a flag last year at AFL level. Now he wins one in the VFL.
Number 21, Jacob Van Ruin.
Plenty of excitement around this 19-year-old. What a first season from him. 36 VFL goals. And plenty more to come from the 19-year-old from Claremont and Wembley Downs in WA.
Number 22, Blake Howes.
Had a foot injury, stress fracture in his foot from round 4 to round 18. His 5th game back this afternoon. His 10th for the season. In his first year, he's a VFL Premiership player.
Number 26, Sam Wiedemann.
Originally taken by the Ds back in 2015. He's been in and out over 7 years. 10 AFL games this season, 11 VFL as he's divided his time.
Number 27, Luke Dunstan.
Taken by St Kilda at 2013. 2 shoulder reconstructions, a pec injury, cut by the Saints last year. Joined the Ds this year in the team of the year for the VFL. What a super season he had.
Number 33, Oscar Baker.
The Queenslander from Wilston Grange, the Brisbane Lions Academy in Aspley. He's been at the D since 2018.
Number 37, Cade Chandler.
He was a window cleaner back in 2018. Originally from Penong, 70 k's west of Ceduna. Population of 200 people. Went to Norwood, on to Melbourne. What a game he played today.
Number 38, 10 years after winning a VFL Premiership with the Cats, Mitch Brown.
What a great story, Mitch Brown. Geelong took him at the end of 2008. Had a shoulder problem, just couldn't get right. Solved that. What a journey it's been.
Number 40, Taj Woden.
Young up-and-comer, the son of Shane, the Brownlow medalist. He's shown plenty of great signs this season in his 18 VFL games. A lot to look forward to in the years ahead.
Number 41, Judd McVee.
Another from WA, from Geraldton, north of Perth and East Fremantle. Went undrafted in 2021. Picked up on the rookie list. 19 games in his first season.
Number 42, Daniel Turner.
From Albury and the Murray under-18s. Taking the mid-season draft midway through last year. Stress fracture in his foot early. A facial injury as well. He's overcome all of that to get a medal around his neck.
Number 44, Joel Smith.
Speaking of injuries, no one's had more than Joel. What a rough road he's had. 26 AFL games in 7 years. Prodigious talent, gets some reward this afternoon.
Number 45, Andy Maniz Wakefield.
From the Northern Territory, Nightcliff in the NT Thunder. Real X factor, first year as a Category B rookie at Melbourne. A lot to look forward to from
Number
him.
47, Jimmy Munro.
The Moose. 22 games at Sandringham, a two-time best and fairest. At Casey, and now a premiership player in his 10th season in the competition.
Number 57, Aiden Quigley.
Came in for Brett Bowie, who was ineligible after playing in the prelim final, hadn't played enough games this season. The youngster from Yanar, Gippsland under-18s, plays his local footy at Morwell. His fourth year involved in the Casey system.
Number 65, Ryan Valentine.
Playing just his seventh VFL game. 20-year-old from Surrey Park and Oakley under-18s. Was at Collingwood on their development list. Never played. Overcome a fractured thigh early in the season.
Number 68, George Gray.
From Bo Morris and St Bede's. Six flags at Bowie, four at St Bede's. And now one at Casey. George Gray, still only 21.
Number 71, Matthew Buntine.
An inaugural player at the GWS Giants from 2012 to 21. Overcome some injuries of his own, including an ACL. Had an ankle pre-season this year. What a pickup he's been.
Number 79, Corey Ellison.
Plenty of interest from AFL clubs in this young man. 21-year-old from the Dandy under-18s and spent some time at Frankston and local footy at Cranbourne. An emerging young defender.
The Casey captain and Norm Goss medalist, number 52, Mitch White.
Originally from Seaford and St Peters, 3 years on the Melbourne AFL list, wanted to hang around and help this VFL list get to the top of the mountain. And this afternoon, he's done just that. Congratulations to Mitch White, our Norm Goss medalist.
Welcome forward, the VFL Coach of the Year, a premiership player, and now a premiership coach at VFL level, Mark Corrigan.
Firstly, to Southport, congratulations on a fantastic year, boys. Yeah, it's unfortunate it can only be one winner in a game like that, but fierce competitors, and I'm sure he'll be back bigger and stronger next year, so well done. To the VFL for their tireless work in getting this competition up and running. It's obviously got its challenges, but thank you, and yeah, appreciate everything you've done to get us to this point today. To the supporters that came out and braved the elements, thank you very much. It meant a lot to the boys. It was, yeah, some interesting weather, but for you to be here shows how proud and committed you are, and appreciate the support to our club, to Casey, to Melbourne, everyone involved, for being able to provide an opportunity for us to be here from a program point of view, but just the support, fantastic. And finally, to the players, boys, immensely proud, outstanding year, super consistent, led by outstanding leaders. I couldn't say any more. So, yeah, very well done, boys, and enjoy the rewards. Fantastic. Thank you.
I'll obviously second what Coach said there. Southport boys, geez, that was tough. And we knew your boys were going to serve it up right up to us. So I've been in your position, and I know you'll come back bigger and better next year and go again, boys. So well done on the year. To the supporters again, it was shocking out in the middle, so I can't imagine how it would have been in the stands. Thank you guys for coming out. Thanks to Smithies as well. I was meant to thank them before, but I forgot. So just thanks to you guys for supporting us all this year. And boys, we bloody did it. Well done.
Gives me great pleasure to now welcome forward a man who captained Springvale to three premierships in the 1990s, the first of those here on this ground in 1996 against Frankston. A giant of the competition and also the Springvale and Casey football clubs. Please welcome Kane Taylor forward to present the Smithies VFL Premiership Cup for 2022 to Mitch White, Mark Corrigan and Casey.
The Casey Demons bury their September Demons. Casey, the champions of the VFL for 2022.
For all these Casey players, particularly those who have been part of the program for so long. But as we mentioned, as each player got up, they've come from far and wide, right across the country.
Yeah, there's no better feeling. The next sort of 30 or 40 minutes, they'll go back into the room, so they'll see their family, they'll sing the song. Just absolutely outstanding. You work tirelessly year in, year out to get an opportunity, and they took theirs today.
You were one of the judges in the Norm Goss Medal. We mentioned during the call what a challenging vote that was. Mitch White in the end got the nod with 29 touches, 9 clearances, 11 contested possessions, 13 tackles, and the job he did on Dawson holding him to 19.
Yeah, he was absolutely superb. I mean, Kate Chandler played really well, Jimmy Munro as well. There are a lot of really good players out there today for Casey and for Southport, but I thought the captain really led the way, both with his defensive job, but then offensively, he worked off his direct opponent and really impacted.
Jimmy Munro known for his defensive stuff, but today he pops up with our United goal of the day.
It was a beauty too, wasn't it? Under a bit of pressure there in the third quarter. They were coming, Southport, and he threw it on the right boot. He got a nice shepherd on the line, and that was just a terrific goal. And he's not probably renowned for his goal-kicking ability, 17 tackles, but that is nice polish. And ran about 70 metres celebrating.
So the Brownlow medal tonight, looking forward to that. Who will take Charlie home this year? You'll find out tonight right here on 7. Well, that wraps up another fantastic season of 7 VFL. So many people who work tirelessly behind the scenes to make our jobs easier every weekend. Our incredible 7 VFL crew, they work so hard to deliver our coverage in often challenging conditions like today, led superbly by our team at Jam, our producer Jack Bennett, our director Mac Wiedemann, our executive team Chris Thompson, Luke Tunnicliffe, Cos Cardone, our team at 7 led by Lewis Martin and Gary O'Keefe. Thanks for your support, and our biggest thanks of course to you, our viewers. Your ongoing support of 7 VFL makes it possible for us to bring you the action each and every weekend. We hope you've enjoyed season 2022 as much as we have. So on behalf of Campbell Brown, Nigel Carmody, Michael Barlow, our entire production team here at Icon Park, thanks so much for watching. Enjoy AFLW Grand Final week. Congratulations to Casey, the champions of the VFL for 2022.